everybody, and welcome to Roundtable Live. My name is Bear Taffy, joined by Northern Lion, Rock Lee, Smile, and Mathis Games. Hi there.
Hello.
Hi.
We are a podcast about video games hosted by four mid-20s to late 20s dudes that sometimes show up on time. That's the most important
punctual,
part.
Professional video game commentators.
Welcome
that are always
it.
On time and never sleep through their alarm.
Thank you for joining us. This is our makeup show for yesterday. We normally host this every Tuesday at 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern on twitch.tv/roundtablepodcast. You can also catch the VOD over on youtube.com/BearTaffyMathisGames or RockLeeSmile. You can also catch it on iTunes, SoundCloud, and coming soon to Google Play Music. Fun. Yeah, new platforms. We're moving into the future here.
I'm very passionate about new distribution platforms. Ask me anything.
How
do you like it?
No comment.
No, I want to know. Do you like it?
Next question.
Today's docket is loaded. We got a lot of fun stuff to talk about. One of the big ones is silly as fuck, and it's Sony's attempt to trademark the phrase "Let's Play."
Fuck you,
that's,
Sony.
That's a weird one. 20 years of Pokemon as well. We got an interesting story there. Origin Access, EA's new monthly subscription platform. A little AGDQ recap, as well as Bear gushing about VR for 25 minutes. And Woo! PewDiePie's new YouTube network that was just announced today, which means this was a strategic decision by us to include the most important news story of the week in this show right here. Do you believe me? No? All right.
Bear, when did you get a bass?
That's a Guitar Hero guitar.
That's a Guitar Hero guitar?
Yeah, it's really nice. It's a good looking guitar, man.
You got it hanging on your wall.
Yeah, I got to display it because I don't have anything else to hang on my wall. This is
got to get Amiibos, man.
This is the extent of my possessions.
Oh, shit.
Adults are going to come into your room and they're going to see that you have two Guitar
Hero controls.
What do you
think I bring over here? I'm here by myself. It's me and my wife.
At some point, an adult you need to court the respect of, like an accountant or a lawyer or a real estate agent, is going to see that.
You have far too high of expectations for the quality of my life, man.
And they're going to say, I can't represent you because...
Shovel Knight Amiibo, shut up. This is great.
Now, that's pretty good. I like the Amiibos.
So, you know, they actually designed this so that I can scan it without ever taking it out of the box.
Really?
Yeah. I'm so happy about that. It's the first Amiibo that I own that I can use.
Look what I have.
I'm very excited.
I have a remote-controlled light that
Shit,
I can control
son.
From
that's
my phone.
Pretty sweet. That's the kind of future tech shit that you've got.
If you three had a triple dorm in freshman year of college, Nick would definitely have the cool corner right now.
He'd have a lava
lamp, light
too.
This light responds to my voice if I want it to.
Oh, no way.
Hang
All
on.
Right. Okay.
Now you got me interested.
Disco mode, disco mode, disco mode. It really works.
If you
Every
have sensitivity
bit of it
to flashing lights.
Yeah.
Thanks disco for the, mode.
Thanks
disco
for the sub, mode. By the way, Troy Salmon. You're called. The first to test our new subscription notification on Twitch, so that's
Your
active
subscription
now.
Subscription notification?
Yeah, we're not going to call too much attention to it, but it exists. Let's go ahead and start off with Sony just being a bag of dicks. They're kind of just being a bag of dicks. The United States Patent and Trademark Office rebuffed Sony Computer Entertainment of America's attempt to trademark the phrase "Let's Play." Now, it's not for the reasons that you're hoping for, although maybe those were being held in the back burner just in case things didn't go their way the first time. The reason they were denied the trademark was because there is already a trademark established in 2013 by Let's Play of America, but that's Let's with a Z, so you can understand where the confusion lies. So first of all, am I wrong in interpreting this as just Sony being assholes? Because I'm being pretty blunt about it, and I feel like I'm justified in that.
I mean, they didn't originate the concept, and they don't really have anything to do with it. No.
But they saw buckets of money.
Assholes. Yeah, that's where I land, too, pretty much.
It's a straight shot to buckets of money, and the only way to get there is to be enormous assholes.
I don't really understand the point of even trying to establish the trademark. Like, I mean, obviously you can go like full on tinfoil hat. They want to copyright match all videos on YouTube, which is fantasy land. But like, presumably they want to use it then in like some form of marketing or something like that.
Mm.
And they're worried that somebody else will take it. I mean, beyond the fact that there's already, what, like 10 million videos on the internet that are titled Let's Play, and it's like its own genre spawned into itself. There's also like the Rooster Teeth series Let's Play, I have to imagine Rooster Teeth is incorporated on some kind of legal level that would make it hard to establish that precedent. It just seems unusual. It seems tone deaf, I guess.
It's surprising that it's only coming up now. Like, you got to wonder what spurred it, like you mentioned. Like, there must have been something that made them think, okay, we need this trademark for... It's like you said, I'm pretty sure marketing purposes are the most logical excuse.
Keep talking.
It's a very important doorbell, I guess.
You got to get his pizza that he ordered.
Oh,
man.
That's right. Yeah, we know that.
Breakfast.
Okay.
Breakfast.
So comparable things to this. I don't know if we've actually had anyone trying to file a trademark for the phrase Let's Play yet. And there's not really anything else that's exactly like it. Although we do know that companies have been sort of out of touch with just the idea of Let's Plays in general. But that's definitely getting better, wouldn't you say?
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, even the PlayStation 4 allows you to stream from it easily. And it has apps for Twitch and YouTube, which are obviously focused on gaming. At least the Twitch one has to be. Mm-hmm. But, like, it doesn't strike me as like a shot across the bow of content creators. It strikes me more as just like somebody being like, yeah, why not? Let's like, we're going to move forward with this as like a slogan or something. So let's trademark it. That's part of like the standard process that we do. And I guess nobody was like, hey, what about like the fact that that's stupid, I guess.
Wait, so are you saying that it's a chance that maybe they just completely didn't even consider that YouTube has a thing called Let's Play and they're just like, yeah, you know, Let's Play. That's a great idea for a slogan. Let's use that.
I think it was maybe, I mean, it's all conjecture, but I think maybe it was like, this would be a good slogan, and then, you know, somewhere between marketing and legal, nobody was, I guess, savvy enough to chime in and be like, this is not going to work. It was really nice that the court just rebuffed it, like, the same day, even for reasons that are not the reasons we would have expected.
Right. Yeah, it certainly didn't... It didn't stay around long enough for it to be a big dramatic thing that we all had to be hinging on to see whether or not they would actually approve a trademark and thus destroy all of our lives. Then again, the repercussions of this are probably not going to be that serious. I can't imagine they would be just issuing, you know, trademark offenses. Well, I don't know the legal.
The worst that happens is everyone's network builds a tool that can change the words Let's Play to some other set of words.
Mm-hmm.
And then they go through and automate that through everyone's videos, I guess.
Until we get that trademarked, and then we go to the next one, and then Nintendo comes along and trademark that
one. Well, because I was going to say, how many freaking people can we give royalties to, right?
Mm-hmm.
YouTube's got to take their third. Nintendo's obviously got to take some of it, because why not? Sony might as well have some. Why not give some to Microsoft? Everybody should have some.
We've had the fun conversation about whether or not it's ideal to be a Nintendo YouTuber before. Which
I think
is
we've
not.
Had that talk.
Yeah. It's not. Yeah, that's about the gist of it. It's every time we think about it, though, it is fun to think, okay, so you take your original number, and then you knock off 40%, you knock off 10%, you knock off 25%, and then you just take some money out for shits and giggles.
I can't get in this woods again of like, oh, it's so hard for us. Like, we're fine.
Yeah.
Every once in a while, there's a cataclysmic, apocalyptic thing like Sony trying to trademark Let's Play, and then it fades away, and then it's like, oh, some things are getting content ID matched, and then it mostly sort of fades away, and then there's managed versus affiliate, it fades away. Like, I don't know. I can't play the violin that this much. It's like four times a year.
This one is mostly just, I think we sort of went off on a tangent on the whole Nintendo thing.
Joking hyperbole is
really
all it is.
Sony's is not really, they don't have a background of being out of touch, at least to this extent. So that's what's interesting about it is Sony is not the one we're going to raise pitchforks at immediately. Like, imagine if Konami did this, especially now. Like, if Konami tried to file a trademark for Let's Play, they would be torched metaphorically on the internet. It's just sort of a goof. It's like when your like 60-year-old uncle starts to talk to you about games, and then that
takes you down to his naked basement.
Yeah, well, that's true too. That
the
was
naked
a weird
puzzle
time.
Basement is what it's
naked
called.
Puzzle basement.
Uncle Nick's naked puzzle basement.
Mm-hmm.
My favorite place.
Let's Play of America, though. I need to know more about now, especially because they spell their name with a Z. That gets me hooked. I'm ready to find out.
Let's play.
Let us play.
Mm-hmm. That's a quick Google. Mm-hmm. The only L-E-T-Z play, perhaps. And of
it's
course,
a non-profit organization that encourages people of all ages to play and helps them create playful events in their own community.
That sounds great.
Cool.
I'm glad they own the trademark. Okay.
There's nothing wrong with that. Uh-huh. I don't think they're going to sue us.
Let's hope so.
You never know.
pretty unlikely.
It's hard up in America. What you do story. Is you just sue people.
Mm-hmm. What if they wanted to write it the normal way and then freaking big YouTube came across and was like, you can't use these words.
That's what happened, huh? Big YouTube's been controlling everything from the beginning, man.
They're so big.
Yeah, it's gross. Sony is silly. Agreed. Nintendo has some good news heading their way, though. First of all, Pokemon Red came out in Japan.
I like how when you said that, you grabbed your earphones like you're getting fed the lines. You're like, Pokemon
good
Red.
News now, yes.
20 years old.
From the past, we've confirmed that Pokemon Red did indeed release in Japan in 1996, which is 20 years ago. That's so old. And now they're celebrating 20 years of Pokemon with the release of a new 3DS that contains Pokemon Red and Blue pre-installed, which might be the worst selling point for a new console I've heard in a long while.
If you're a Pokemon fanatic, maybe it's worth it.
A
I saw some people on Twitter like all over. They're like, I can't wait. I want it.
Okay, I'll admit, though, having said that, I did as recently as my honeymoon just go through another playthrough of Pokemon Blue.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that was most of my time on the airplane. Also in the room on our cruise for a lot of the time. And one time out on the deck of the boat. And then I started to feel really bad about myself because I realized I was playing Pokemon Blue on the deck of a cruise ship on my honeymoon.
This is a good honeymoon, clearly.
You know, life experiences, why not?
You gotta learn sometime.
I have one bitter line to get out before we continue this story. And you know what else is old? Fucking Metroid.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah. I mean, it is old.
Anyway, moving on.
No.
No, that is the whole story. I just wanted to say, come on.
When does Metroid get the 20-year anniversary edition?
We got a new Metroid, man. It was called Metroid Other M.
No, I'm actually curious, like, what's the 20-year anniversary of Metroid?
I don't know. Let's look.
Probably, like, 2006.
So that was a while ago, then.
Super Metroid already had its 20-year anniversary, if that's what we care about. So it's older than that. Jeez. They just didn't give a shit.
We're coming up on the 20th anniversary of Super Smash Brothers, man.
Wow. Oh, wow. What?
That'd be like 98, 99.
That made me feel so my God. Old. I remember playing the shit out of that.
All right, favorite Pokemon memories, now that I've shared mine. Mathis, I know you've got some.
Favorite Pokemon memories? Mm-hmm. Probably waking up when Pokemon like Gold and Silver came out on Christmas and sitting on the couch with my brother and discovering for the first time that there were Pokemon that were time sensitive. Like, so you had to be playing at night to get a Pokemon that came out at night, and that blew my mind. And just playing with my brother and being able to trade Pokemon back and forth. Like, I luckily had that luxury where I had somebody who, if I got Blue, he got Red. If I got Silver, he got Gold. And that made it a lot of fun. I loved it.
I remember those fun days, man. I was a lot less jaded about features.
Like, we were kids.
Yeah, he told me about day-night cycles and share cables, and I was like, man, that shit's awesome. And now I see
meanwhile,
it.
Glitching it. A bearded 30-year-old man sat blogging into his BBS. Fucking gotta find someone who owns Pokemon Red, give my link cable so I can actually get my Abra evolved. Nintendo trying to, look at this scummy tactic, trying to get them to sell two copies of the game to the same person.
Actually, you'd be looking for the Kadabra to evolve, not the Abra, because the Kadabra is the one you need to trade with someone to get the Alakazam.
That's a really good voice like that.
And the duplicate glitch, like halfway through the trade, if you yanked the cables, he'd get his and you get to keep yours.
No, yeah, you're the
stick
asshole,
it to the
though.
Man.
Yeah, fuck you, Nintendo!
Fucking up the Pokemon economy.
You do that to somebody in your class, though, so you run away, but then remember that you just have to go sit next to them in math in an hour, so it doesn't really work out. That happened to me. That's, you know,
dude,
long story.
I had to use the Game Genie to get Missing No. And do any of you remember the Game Genie?
I do remember the Game Boy?
Not the Game
specific,
Boy.
It had, so there's like this box that claps onto the top of the Game Boy, right? Mm-hmm. And in the back of it, there's a little door that opens up. And inside the door is this tiny little booklet with like 10 million codes inside of it.
I remember it, yeah.
And you flip through it like this. It's so cute. So like, I need the code to get the Missing No. It's totally not in there because all it has is like fucking Tetris.
You need a fucking microscope to single out individual
codes. I kind of want to go look through my shelf behind me and find the Game Boy with the Game Genie because I still have it sitting back there.
Yeah.
Then I'll be gone for 15 minutes. I don't think you care.
Ryan, you got Pokemon memories, right?
Oh, yeah. I was like really into Pokemon, but only for like one generation. Mm-hmm. So I owned Blue, Red, and Yellow despite being an only child. I have no idea why I bought Red after also getting Blue, but I played through all three of them, which were basically the same game, except in yellow, Pikachu follows you around behind you, which is pretty dope. I did a speech in fifth grade on Pokemon.
Yes!
Speech?
All right, how much of it do you remember?
Literally zero. But I'm pretty sure like I brought like a Nintendo Power to school and then just like copied, basically like rephrased the Nintendo Power article on Pokemon and spoke.
Did the teacher check you for plagiarization?
That's not a plagiarism, as long as you put it in your own words. All right. In fifth grade, at least.
that's the rule set in fifth grade. Once you get out at junior high, they start to strict it up a little bit.
And then in probably like sixth grade, Pokemon cards started to become a big deal. And like I got a couple packs, and my friend got a couple of packs. We didn't really make a deck. We just sort of battled. But he got a Charizard and was super stoked, but I got a Blastoise, so I always beat him. Nice. He'd always be like, I sent out Charizard. I'm like, all right, Blastoise. There you go.
I
remember it was. I think it was a different Christmas. I got Pokemon cards and I opened the holographic Venusaur and I was pumped. Yeah. That same day, I dropped a tin box on it and punctured a hole right through it.
He dropped a tin box on it.
Yeah. Yep. I dropped a tin box on it.
So scarring. You remembered the
no.
Type
I remember.
Of metal.
It. And I remember being like ruined for like a week. Like I was gonna get rich off that card.
What happened to your holographic Venusaur, Mathis? Dropped a scandium box on it.
It was so bad.
That's a dope metal reference.
Scandium. It's a good one.
I've got stories and stories actually.
Nobody asked you, Bear.
What? Oh,
you're the host.
Will you ask me? Will you ask
Bear,
me so I can tell
me
about
your
it?
Best Pokemon story?
So when I was probably, this is in third grade maybe, I had amassed myself a little collection of the cards, and I got a little holographic Pinsir. I remember the creature, and I remember the color of the card. It was green. His name was Pinsir.
Mm-hmm. It would be green. He's a bug.
That's right. It's true. Insect type.
Pinsir
was going to say
brown,
but
fucking savages.
Pinsir was a badass, is what
saying
he was.
Saying insect type is green, god damn it.
Oh, insect type is green. Okay.
Saying he's brown is racist. So I brought this card, which had a misprint on it, which was very rare. Oh, you got to know that, right? This thing's worth a fortune. Right, so I brought it to this card shop, and this dude is just like this. This guy had no business working in a kid's store, man.
Yo, a card shop's not a kid's store. We're fighting hard against this.
No, I'm saying, like, this is pre-Magic Resurgence card shops, right? So this is in a mall, and he's selling, like, a fucking... He's got a kiosk of Pokemon shit, right? So next to this dude who looks like a straight-up biker thug, he's got... I'm maybe misremembering this, but I'm pretty sure he had a multicolored faux hawk and a tattoo that said Kanye is life. So that was neither here nor there. But
make any sense.
Yeah, he was
Bear, are you
going to
be at this for
too.
A second? Because
anyway,
I'm just going to get the game genie.
Pinsir,
okay.
I thought was worth a fortune, right? I bring this card up to this dude. He looks at it for 2.5 seconds. I counted. He says $16. But he said it with an attitude, right? He's like, 16 bucks, and he throws it at me like it's a piece of shit. And I said, and I left.
I thought you were going to be like, and I said, all right.
No, man.
Now that...
I'm not selling my misprint Pinsir for $16, man.
Now that
so
holographic Pinsir sits in the bottom of a shoebox somewhere, location unknown. Instead
could've
of
been $16.
To generate some money for that local game store and also spread the love of that card to somebody who could have used it.
And I still have that Pinsir to this day. I don't know.
A Pinsir was the
you
Pokemon.
You could have sent it off, man. Get graded by a professional like card grader.
Yeah, get that 10 on there.
When I was a kid, I was like,
there it is!
Pokemon
yes!
would be sweet if it was in real life. Mm-hmm. And then I thought about Pinsir, who has like big fucking horns and a mouth that is like flat and is sideways. Like it's got sideways teeth. And I was like, nah, dog.
Some Pokemon, you don't want to see that shit in the wild, man. That would freak you out.
A fucking like Electabuzz or something. It's just a man in a yellow and black suit.
These are intelligent. These are intelligent animals that can understand your conversation. You want to enslave them in real life.
No, man. Some of them are evil. You know, there's some evil fucking Pokemon, man. Like, imagine finding Mewtwo. Your ass
But he was genetically created. He was made by people.
Technically, everything is genetically created.
Well, he was, like, created in a lab by people. He was an experiment.
Nick, tell me you still have the booklet.
I do. I'm just cleaning because the case that it was in, like, degraded, and it looked like it had black mold all over it, but it was just little bits of, like, fabric, I guess.
Oh, good.
But yeah, the back swings open. You can see it actually through that little door. See that? Yeah, that's the booklet.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the little door. And
audio
then we...
only listeners are missing out on just a glorious piece of nostalgia.
Oh my,
right
I never
now.
Had this. This is like, this is hot.
You gotta describe it to them. The size of the item that you're holding in your hands
it's
is the
like
most important thing.
Less than 2 inches long.
Yeah.
Oh god, oh! Damn, it just fell out.
This is one of a kind. There's nothing else like it in the world.
It looks like a child's, like an infant's book that you would put in their crib with them as a decoration.
People were telling me this didn't exist and that there was only Game Shark. And I was like, fuck that. No, here it is. So there's tiny, tiny little text inside.
Can't even Lord. Focus on it.
There's no better use for the gif of that. I can't think of his actor, yeah. But he's just like.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's got way too many things in it for how big this is, which is not big.
That's
and so
best.
You're supposed to go through this and enter these, 9-digit codes one at a time. Each time you start up the game.
Now I know why you need glasses after all that time. It's just like staring at it.
It's got Mickey's Dangerous Chase Game, Mr. Chin's Gourmet Paradise Game. All of them say game at the end. Mercenary Force Game.
Just in case you forget, right?
Anis, did you just take a bite out of the crust first?
No.
Did you take a bite out of the side of that? Okay.
No, that's a standard pizza.
That's
bite.
A disregard.
You got a little confused.
It's also clearly
man.
Domino's with a product placement.
Oh, yeah.
Man.
It's the only thing that delivers at this hour around
all
me.
Yeah, that's fair.
It's delicious, though. Pineapple and feta cheese.
You know, I remember Pokemon was the first thing and the last thing to make me punch a kid in the face.
Okay. Yeah.
Wow. What?
But it was entirely accidental, and I felt really bad afterward.
Remember this?
It's a very That's simple story. We were sitting trading cards, and I heard him say something that I found offensive, so I feigned a punch, but That's... accidentally actually punched
but
him
you
in
connected.
The face. Yeah. And broke his glasses. So that was
nice.
That was a great friendship that lasted that whole year. You know, those are the times that I was glad that I was a military kid because that just meant, well, okay, I'm going to chalk this up to I never have to see this kid again in a year and a half. And I'm going to live in a whole new place. We're going to start fresh.
I thought you meant it. You made him move away.
Oh, yeah.
That's how like intimidate his dad or something.
How many punches have you seen at Friday Night Magic, Ryan?
I haven't seen anybody throw a punch, but... There was one time there was like a serious argument between two dudes and over like a blocking mechanic. And the one dude was like, I will bet you $200 that this is how the blocking mechanic works. And the judge was just like, well, according to the rule book, this is not. And then he's like, you know what? Fine. I concede. And then he just like walked out.
Man. You know, I think there might have been some underlying problems there.
May
I
just
point
out, I don't
think the blocking mechanic
is the prize
for
coming first in Friday Night Magic is the equivalent of $16 in booster packs. So this guy
yeah, but
put,
you could have pulled a Jace Vrinch Prodigy, man.
This guy put almost 20 times the grand prize of the tournament on the line for this one thing.
That's how confident he was.
Apparently
just do like
20 wrong.
Bucks, man. That's all you need to say. It's better than the first place prize, and you're good to go.
Pokemon's fun. I like it.
I will probably never play another Pokemon game in my life, but as far as like re-releases go, it's been 20 years. You get like a couple anniversaries that are okay to re-release, right?
Yeah.
20th anniversary, absolutely. 10th anniversary, probably fine too.
You're almost exactly describing the appropriate time to go to your high school reunions.
Absolutely true.
Like
if you go to
like
your third year high school reunion, you got to get out of that town.
Well, that might just be like you and a couple other people going to a Denny's because I'm pretty sure they don't do those anymore.
What, high school reunions?
Yeah, no, not for like 3 years. I'm pretty sure they only give it to you for like 5, 10, 20.
That's just when you show up at like the homecoming dance, even though you graduated like 3 years ago.
You're still getting asked, man. There's freshmen.
I remember you were in 9th grade when I was in 12th grade.
Mm-hmm.
Are you guys old enough for your 10-year high school reunion yet?
Almost.
Mine's this year, actually.
No, hey, is it?
Already, mine was passed already a
mine
couple
passed,
years ago.
Yeah, mine passed, too. Did you go to yours?
No.
Me either.
I don't know anyone anymore from there. They're all fucking doctors and lawyers, and I'm fucking YouTube Let's Playing.
Hey, man,
don't
phrase it like that.
I'm not even kidding. Many of them are lawyers now. It really is a thing.
But you turn that around, and you're like, see, I'm the only one there who managed to become a YouTube Let's Player.
Yeah,
they're all fucking right. Doctors and lawyers wasting
fucking
their time.
Easy
not
stream
on the
for them.
PewDiePie Network, so I don't think it counts.
My 10-year reunion is hosted at a Dave and Buster's on the night before Black Friday in a mall. I was like, you're all
that sounds
that's
fun.
Real weird.
And I'm like, I am not going to a mall the Thursday before the biggest shopping day
out of Dave and Buster's.
It probably wouldn't really impact it, would it? I mean, like, it would maybe make the traffic a little worse.
I don't want to go to the mall. It's Black Friday tomorrow.
Yeah, but still, like, you don't think that people start their sales early now.
Yeah, that's true. They do have, like, the Thursday Blockbuster or Doorbuster deals.
You go to Dave and Buster's, have a couple drinks, and then when you leave, pick up a flat screen.
Shit, I missed out.
You got the fast ticket.
Not Thanksgiving, guys. Oh, shit. No, it was that week, though.
I
can't remember. It was like Black Friday.
It's called Thanksgiving.
I won't be going to my 10-year reunion because it's like across the country.
It was like before or right after. It was like right around Black Friday. Why did I think it was the Thursday? That is Thanksgiving.
I feel like 10 years is like not enough, and 20 is too much. Like after 10 years, people are still kind of fluid. They're figuring stuff out. When you're like 36, you're not going to be like, or 38, I guess. You're not going to be like, I want to go back to high school, relive the moments. Hopefully.
Well, the jocks will.
Yeah, the idea is that it's there for the people that need it, I guess, right? It's more of a support system than anything at that point. So, if you need the 30-year high school reunion, then I think you've got a deeper
30-year, I'd almost be okay with. Because really? Then that's like enough distance to be like, your life is set.
You're 48 at this point.
You're 48, and it's like, I don't need to see you ever again, because what I'm observing at this point tells me everything. If you've already got your shit sorted, you're good, man.
I don't live a good life. Out of it though. Like,
if you're a little shaky, if you're on shaky ground, then it's just, I don't know. It's like after a movie when they show you like, whoa, Bert was killed later that year. You're like, oh, closure. It's like, I can close the book on all those people from my...
You don't have to go to hear about that, though. And I mean, like, you can hear Bert was killed from the grapevine. You don't have to go to the Dave and Buster's the night before the mall opens up for Black Friday to hear about it.
I figure by the time you're 50, you've got the friends you've got, and if any of them are still from your high school era, you'll know who they are and when they're around. So going to the high school is just like, you're just bragging.
Yeah, it's like you said, Nick.
I don't know. At 50, I think it's more like you have enough distance from your youth to have some perspective on it.
Right, start picking up.
You go back, it's a little bit of a, Stand By Me kind of moment. If you go back when you're 26, you're still an idiot. 27, 28. I'm 27, I'm still an idiot. I was an idiot when I was 17.
Yeah, but we make a living being idiots now.
That's technically true.
Speaking of which, let's get back to the podcast real fast here.
Oh, sorry, jeez.
I'll take a bite out of my brownie.
I like that one, though. Origin Access, advertised by 5 Bill Nyes, EA's new PC subscription gaming service. Sort of designed to compete with PlayStation Plus and Xbox Live Gold in a way, but, you know, it's PC exclusive. Also exclusive to EA products. So if you're looking for more of a varied selection, you're probably not going to be getting it from this. Although the actual selection of games itself is pretty varied, though.
If you buy Origin Access and then you go, wait a minute, these are all EA games. It's like,
you fucked up.
Yeah. Sorry, that's on you.
Very true. The early subscribers here, and I'm calling it early because this is sort of the early adopters phase of this whole process, will get access to the Vault. The EA Vault, which contains some decent offerings. They've got the entire Dead Space line in there. I think they've got SimCity, Dragon Age, Dragon Age 2. I think Inquisitions is in there as well.
Yeah.
And I think Battlefield. A few pretty awesome titles.
Get them now like before they go back into the EA Vault. Locked away
like
for
Disney.
10 years.
Exactly, yeah. And then the Origin subscriber or the Origin Access subscribers also receive an additional 10% off on all their Origin purchases, and they get access to entire games before they are released. The first one is going to be Unravel, which is a new yarn puzzle platformer that's being released in February.
It's interesting.
A new way to spin the beta again, or
yeah, more or less, right? Yeah. So the way that they describe it is that you get access to the full game. And it's a limited trial period, so I'd imagine it's probably something like 48 hours where you can hop on and play a game if it's available on the Vault. And then they take it away after that, and you have the option to buy it, and then your progress carries over with that. So it's not a trial or a demo. It is the full game, but there's just a limited time window for you to play it.
I don't know. Like, it's a cool idea. I like it, but I mean, I don't know if I care about playing the game super early because, you know, whatever. That doesn't bother me too much. Did you hear about the Amazon thing that just kind of got announced, though?
Yeah.
I guess we're going talking about Origin Access.
No, because we could talk about it.
They are
the
going
value,
side by side.
The
yeah.
value of EA versus the value of Prime membership now.
Right.
Because Prime members get 20% off the game up via pre-ordering it and 2 weeks after its launch.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, if you're a Prime member and you in like after the game launches, you read the reviews, you could still get that 20% off any new purchase of a game, which I find far more valuable because I'm assuming you know you're gonna get EA games off Amazon if you want.
Mm.
That might hold a little bit more value if you're a Prime member already. Now, granted, Prime membership is expensive comparatively, but if I feel like if you want Prime, you probably already have it, and if you have Prime. Why do you, is playing the right. EA game a little earlier that much more valuable to you? It's interesting.
This is $5 a month, by the way. I think I failed to mention that right at the beginning.
Yeah, I think you said
this is $5 a month
versus Prime, which is $100 for a year.
Yeah but of course that has a lot more intrinsic
right.
value.
Correct.
A lot of value added, and it's not necessarily that you're going to be buying that specifically to get discounts on games.
Right.
You probably add it for the two-day free shipping.
Hearing that news was just. Like, literally no downside, which is the best news. You hear, oh, I get to save more money, and I already have this thing. Hooray!
Yeah.
That's a good start to my day.
Yeah, they're good with the value added. I like it.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like Origin Access is one of those things that doesn't make that much sense for us, but if you were, like, 14, you'd be like, this is pretty dope. For $5 a month, I get access to Battlefield 4, which I can play forever, basically. And then a couple of games that I'll at least try out and might get a lot of time out of. Like, they have Hardline, SimCity, you can play last year's FIFA. They're never going to put... It's always going to be 1 year behind.
Yeah.
But, like, I feel like it's one of those services where you'd be like, this is really cool if you are on, like, a limited income.
And if you're older than 14 and interested in this, grow up.
It's, like... EA Access, it's not called Origin Access on Xbox One, obviously, but EA Access on Xbox One is one of those things that I've been interested in but just haven't done because I'm like, I'd rather just buy like the game I want once than pay $5 a month for everything, I guess. But yeah, I actually agree that it's kind of like renting. It's like a weird rental service. I think it's good. I mean, $60 a year, at least if you did it for like 1 year, you get a great value.
I like the price point especially. I think the price point shows that they understand that they need to compete at a very enticing level, you know? They're not going to be able to get in here with something like $12 a month. They can't compete with who they're trying to compete with an offering like this at $12 a month. They knew that they had to get in really low, and they're actually, you know, they're making a good offering with the Vault too. It's not a lot like EA to do something like this, I feel. They're really sort of starting to turn it around.
Yeah.
Since the Sims debacle, or not the Sims debacle, but the SimCity debacle, I think especially, they're realizing that, you know, they sort of can't get away with as much as maybe they thought they could for a while there. And now it's getting a little better.
Well, there's always the chance that, well, cynical me, of course, coming up here, but I always feel like when something seems a little too good to be true, especially given their track record, what if this is just the enticement level where they're going to say, look, it's only $5.
Yeah.
Get a few months go by and start raising the price a little bit.
I don't know.
It goes up to 20.
I don't see them raising the price. I
they add a little more
that.
Value. They add a few more games, then the price goes up a lot, and then what happened to this?
I don't see it as that. I see it as... Well, okay, I'm not going to try to say they're really turning it around, Nick. Come on. Give EA some credit.
Well, you know, I also have to play devil's advocate, right? Mm-hmm. Otherwise, what's the point?
I like the idea, like, maybe they'll add added value, but I feel like instead of upping the price, they'll start, if this happened, they'd add tiers.
Right.
You can stay at the base 5 tier if you want, like, whatever they add, 10.
Oh.
I see that might be what they
well, what
maybe
they,
would
what
do.
What do they add to this that makes it
oh,
more
I don't
valuable?
Know.
$30 a month, you get every season pass for all their games every time they come out.
Yeah, okay, maybe.
And that
Let
way
me
you can
be
pay,
the,
you can pay
the
two
one...
levels ahead for the season pass.
Yeah.
Let me be the one to just say I think this is a good decision, I'll leave it to EA to make the mistake before I criticize them for it.
Or Not give them yet. Any more ideas as to what to do.
For right now, I'm like, man, for $10, you could play the shit out of Battlefield 4 for like 2 months, and beat Dragon Age Inquisition. That's a really good value right there. I kind of feel like it's one of those things you never want to stay subscribed to, because right now you're getting like 30 games or 15 games for $5, but then it's going to add what, like a game every 3 or 4 months? So in a year, this subscription is probably going to look like a lot worse.
They
it's
have
like,
to...
like getting Photoshop or something.
Yeah, yeah.
After a while, you'd much rather have just bought it than be paying $12 a month for it.
They have to keep adding things to the vault to keep subscribers. I think that's the given.
Well, yeah.
But it has to. It can't be new games.
Yeah, I guess so. So
or they would go out of business.
So they very clearly then just withheld a few titles to be able to introduce those at a later date. That makes sense. And then the trials thing is going to be the other big selling point. So they've got Unravel first, and I don't know, they don't really do much for their non-Battlefield Dragon Age sports games, you know? Like, they don't get a lot of love. So I'm wondering even if they look at this as a major selling point, if that's just sort of like a extra thing to them.
I think it's a way to recover. It's not even really recover, but just to kind of exploit their back catalog for money they wouldn't otherwise get.
Yeah.
And exploit, obviously, is a super loaded word. I don't mean it like that, but it's, I mean, like the games.
Functionally, it's the right word.
Yeah. A lot of these games are not going to be making very much money anymore. So better to throw them in and like
Nintendo
make
does
the subscription
it with their
look nice.
Virtual console, like every company is doing it in some way.
It's EA's official Humble Bundle for their own work.
More or less, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, though, you got to give them credit for this because the idea of paying $5 a month or just doing it once, just pay $5 and then for a month you can play through this War of Mine and Dead Space and you play a bunch of SimCity. Like, you can get all this done in a month easily, and that's a great value. So kudos to them for that, at least. I mean, that alone is probably reason enough for a few people to subscribe for a month and then cancel.
Yeah.
All right.
That, or you could get 1/3 of a month of World of Warcraft.
Aha. Uh-huh.
Shit.
Shouldn't open
it
up. That can't
work. Blizzard.
I'm just saying, to put it in perspective, it's pretty cheap. Yeah.
All right. Real quick, we want to touch on AGDQ because it sort of feels obligatory to at least mention it. The fact that they managed to raise over $1 million again for charity is pretty fantastic. Woo! So we got to give them kudos for that. If you have no idea what we're talking about, AGDQ is Awesome Games Done Quick. It's a yearly event hosted on Twitch. Usually gets a couple 100,000 viewers, so a lot of you probably know what I'm talking about. And this year was no different. Always awesome. A lot of really good runs. What were some of your favorite runs from this year's event? Anyone at all?
Anybody?
Two players, one controller, Super Metroid. That's badass. I've never seen that run.
That seems pretty sweet.
I liked the Half-Life 2 run by Noir. He was really funny. Yeah. My favorite part is how the announcer that whole time just kept calling him Noir. And I wanted to punch him in the face. I'm like, it's N-O-I-R. Come on.
Noir.
But I think Half-Life 2 is the first time I've ever watched Half-Life 2 speedrun. And like the movement of that reminds me of like Tribes. There's a lot of like skiing down slopes and then glitching away to maintain that momentum. Mm-hmm. And just like ripping through the levels really, really fast. That was really interesting.
Has there been another game like Tribes that you know, fills that void in my heart of being able to just skirt around the map like crazy?
Yo, Shoot Mania was like that.
Yeah?
Shoot Mania is... If I had known you guys more in, like, 2012, probably, like, March of 2012, I'd be like, yo, it sounds stupid as hell, but you guys got to get Shoot Mania and play it with me.
Yeah.
You think you plays bad, go back to Ubisoft Europe's fucking Mania servers, where they had their own platform that was Ubisoft-specific for Shoot Mania and Track Mania. It was the dumbest shit of all time.
That sounds terrible.
Shoot Mania was pretty fun, though.
Okay.
It's dead.
I remember playing Track Mania. It was one of the earlier games I played, like when I was getting to know you. Track Mania was fun. But that was
Track Mania is dope, and the new one comes out next month, I think.
Oh, shit. That'll be fun. I'm down for
that. Remember that server you had?
Yeah.
Never worked.
Yeah, the Track Mania server took forever to get set up, and then we used it like twice. Probably spent like maybe $180 on that.
Oh, nice. Jesus.
Yeah, it was a good return on that expense.
I got to, I didn't wake up for it. It was like 6 in the morning Pacific, so I wasn't going to dedicate myself that much to it. But I did catch the VOD of the Spelunky run, which went surprisingly well.
Oh, it was so good.
Yeah,
I watched
really
it live.
It. Mm-hmm. It was a good time. Also, right after that, I can't believe I didn't realize they were doing this, but somebody did Spooty Biscuit. I'm gonna remember his name because, goddamn, it was impressive. A Coda Necrodancer run, which out of the developers' mouths, it's been said, we don't think Coda is possible to complete, which is crazy. That was, like, you know, just after release. And it actually took a while after that for anybody to complete Coda, which is unusual when a developer says something like that. You know, usually, well, it's unusual in the way that you wouldn't think, because usually when a developer says something like that, somebody does it within 12 hours.
T-Rex, yeah.
Yeah. Usually. So Coda has been insanely difficult since release, and I'm pretty sure only 10 people have ever beaten Coda. And somebody beat Coda at AGDQ. Spooty Biscuit beat Coda at AGDQ. That is crazy. That is insanely cool. And if you don't know who Coda is, or Necrodancer, Necrodancer is a rhythm-based roguelike game, and Coda is a very difficult character to play. He moves at double speed, can't pick up gold, and can only wield the dagger. So just so many limitations, and it's so insane to watch. Like, I seriously highly recommend if you haven't checked it out. Yeah, you really should watch it. It's insanely impressive. And then other than that, I didn't really catch that much this year. I did watch a little bit of the Super Mario Maker relay race, which was pretty awesome to see. And that made me really excited about the future of like Super Mario Maker at AGDQ in general as well. Super Mario Maker is really stuck around in a really good way. It's pretty great. And
I didn't watch any AGDQ.
Okay, that's fair.
There were people tweeting about the dude playing Beatmania. And I waited.
I saw a couple of those, yeah.
Like six people tweeted, and they're like, "You got to see this." Mm. And then I clicked on it, and he got up from the chair and left.
It's over.
All right. But that I saw the GIFs, which are pretty amazing.
Yeah, that was me last year when they started freaking out about the Tetris Grandmaster. Yeah. Run. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That was amazing.
That was pretty great.
The Tetris run last year was really crazy.
Did they do that again this year?
There was no Tetris.
No Tetris, man.
It might be at the SGDQ. We'll see. Mm-hmm.
Seems Hope like so. They mix up the groupings of what they play every year a little bit.
No,
anyway.
I like that they've switched it up quite a bit. I would not have expected Spelunky and Necrodancer both sort of surprised me to see them on the lineup too. Like, I didn't know they were.
Binding of Isaac was on it. Like. The last time or the time before that.
Yeah, it sort of fell into the same category. It surprised me that they were willing to, you know, sort of take a risk. I really think they honestly must have expected that the Coda run may not even get finished. So you know, prep yourselves for failure. The worst case scenario is, I didn't make it. Sorry, everybody. And then we go on to the next game.
Well, a lot of things like that happened, and there was a lot of things they had to jump to backup saves. And, I mean, one of the last ones they did a Super Metroid reverse ball sorter run. Which, you know, he died a bunch of times because he's fucking running around in everywhere hot with Novaria suit.
Mm.
And that kills you really fast. That was very impressive. Never seen that run done before.
That was
cool. And I appreciate that it's still possible to do new things with Super Metroid after I've watched and played that for like 20 years.
Yeah, that was actually the other point I was going to make, is that I love that in a lot of the games that have sort of just become staples of AGDQ and these events, they're finding new things to do every year, which is insane.
Symphony of the Night, too. They also had a different run with that, too.
And I think Kyle, our friend Kyle, actually, Full Grown Gaming, was a part of a run at AGDQ. He did the four-player co-op Majora's Mask run, and they were talking the entire time about how they're still developing strategies to
five and a half
game.
Hour run.
Yeah, no kidding.
I was watching that. I've watched Kyle run it on Twitch a couple times, and I always think if I was ever going to get into speedrunning, speedrunning a game that takes 5.5 hours is something I would never want to touch with a 10-foot pole.
They don't do that run very often, and I think since they split it up, that was like, they split it across four people because it's so freaking long.
Mm-hmm.
Just the usual
gone
run
home
for
speedruns.
Gone Home, I could finish that in like 3 minutes.
What is it, like 45 seconds or something?
Is it even okay? It might be shorter than 3 minutes.
Without spoiling the game, I'm pretty sure you can get to the ending right at the start
immediately.
You can.
Again, don't go looking for it if this is your first time playing the game.
Well, you'll miss the entire game, so it won't really hurt you that much. You just won't know anything about the game.
Right. Not too bad.
5.5 hours is just ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
So long.
I mean, think about it. There's people doing the Final Fantasy VII speedruns, too, that are taking, dozens of hours. Or not dozens, but maybe
a long time.
Hours.
Because there was like 4 hours into it, they were doing something in Majora's Mask, and they're like, "Yeah, this can be a run killer." I'm like, "A run killer? 4 hours?"
They said that a lot too,
I'm
which
like,
was crazy.
Jesus.
Yeah.
This,
not only is it a 5.5 hour run, but every 5 minutes there's an insanely high risk thing that requires insane technical skill to complete, and they just, this could destroy the run and add 30 minutes to it, but we'll see what happens. Oh, we did it! Hey, all right, cool. Let's move on.
They have backup saves. I think they run into those same things in a lot of the other categories where they're run killers in that segment as well, and then they just bring that same kind of worriedness over to the new category.
Yeah.
I like this. I like this pseudo analysis as semi-casual speedrunning fans that we got going on here, dude. This is good.
It's great. Yeah. I love it. That's like 24 hours, 7 days a week for that 1 week of just background noise. It can always turn on. You're like, there's always something cool to watch.
Yeah, it was sort of like when HDQ. Bob Ross was going, right?
Yeah.
You know, it's like, fun. Well, if you got nothing, you always got AGDQ to turn on.
Yep.
Plus, I was watching it in my new Gear VR Segway. Woo!
Oh, shit.
You got a Segway?
No, not yet.
You got a Gear
I want
to
see you in your Gear VR riding a Segway.
Hold on. I might have it here.
I'm becoming a robot. Oh,
no. I should have had it here, man. I should have had the demo.
I figured
ready.
You were going to put it on. That's where
you were so excited to talk about Gear VR. All
right.
And you didn't even bring the
wife
prop.
Wife Taffy, if you're listening, please bring the Gear VR upstairs so I can
talk
about
shout.
It.
Hey!
Let it all out. These are the things.
So last week, we talked about the Oculus Rift, which went on pre-order, is now available for $600.
We were off by a long
way
shot.
Way off. Yeah. So,
I pre-ordered one.
Yeah, Nick,
I pre-ordered
about
two,
this.
Actually. I accidentally pre-ordered two. So it was a big mess when the thing went live, of course. I was there 3 hours early, and that didn't save me either because, of course, the store completely crashed and broke the site for about half an hour or so. As that was all getting resolved, I was just spamming trying to get my payment to process through, and I didn't want to take my credit card for whatever reason. Eventually, it went through. And I thought I had one, never got a confirmation email. More time went by, still didn't get a confirmation email, and it's now like an hour past when the thing went live. So I'm thinking, well, if this order didn't take, I'm going to be in like the second or third shipment now, which means I'm going to have to wait a couple extra months. I just decided I'd order another one because I could just cancel the other one. There was no obligation to keep your orders in. I ordered the second one. The second one went through much faster, and I got a confirmation about it. So yay, that was finally done, but it was saying that the shipment wasn't till May, which wasn't super great for me. I wanted a little sooner than that. Later, like 2-3 days later, I get an email saying that I did actually order the first one properly, and both of my confirmation codes went through. So then I finally got in contact with someone from customer support who said that they could help me out and cancel the other one. We finally did that yesterday, and today was the day of me realizing I still don't have an account with them to look up my processing. So I still don't know. Like, I have the order, but I can't get to the details about it, so I won't know when it ships.
Sounds fun.
It's a clusterfuck.
It's like 3 days between emails, too, right?
Yes.
Nice.
Yes, yes.
Well, $600. Okay, so price point-wise, how are we feeling?
So I'm okay with it being $600, but the reason people are up in arms about it, I think this has been discussed ad nauseum over the past few days, is that it's not so much that it's $600, it's the fact that every time they talked about final price point, they said ballpark $350.
Mm-hmm.
So when they were like, it's $600, and everybody's like, that's not what you were telling us. Fuck, that's a lot of money. So, I mean, again, though, like, it is what it is. It's $600. I mean, you need a fucking amazing PC to run it anyway, so it's clearly made for early adopter enthusiasts. Anybody else who thought they were going to get it, I mean, even at $350, you still needed, like, a monster PC to make sure it runs smoothly. We'll see. I mean, we'll see what happens. I'm not too mad about it. I don't care.
Aren't you also getting one free with the DK2, though?
No.
That was Kickstarter backers for the...
Only Kickstarter backers get one.
Oh,
and they
okay.
got a special one that's like made for them, which is cool.
Does that have their name on it?
I don't know how the I think it's going to have like the... It's like a special Kickstarter logo version or something.
It only matters.
$600 to me is expensive enough that I will wait and see if anything good comes out for it. And if the price comes down and how the Vive ends up working out.
Well, we're definitely in the early adopters phase here, right?
Yeah.
Safe to say. So
no question.
This is probably going to be a couple years until we even see a Rift price adjustment. Although I think what could be the thing that immediately forces them to reconsider would be a competing price from the HTC Vive, which I don't expect.
I don't either. I think, because the reason it's so fucking expensive is because it's brand new technology with a screen that is incredibly high resolution, that's really small and like jammed into this little thing. The motion tracker technology has to be incredible. Like everything has to be great, and it's new, so it's obviously going to be expensive. If HTC wants to have something similar, as far as like quality is concerned, you're going to be looking at a very similar price. I really honestly think you are.
I think it's going to be more expensive, but
because it's going to come with like the hand motion
way
stuff,
right? Better.
Really?
Yeah. At least like.
Well, we haven't Have you put on the consumer version of the Rift yet? It's going to be different than the DK2.
I would be amazed if anything that the Rift did hit the level of immersion that the Vive did.
Really?
But I haven't used the consumer version of the Vive yet either. I've just used like the.
They're two different kind of experiences, though. I mean, one is more designed for a room experience, and the other is more designed for you to sit. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't really have room for a Vive, so Oculus was kind of what I had.
I think. Well, I don't know. So I haven't used the Vive. I'm a lot more curious about why you just like it feels like it's an objectively better thing in your perspective.
Better, more immersive would probably be the way that I would describe it.
So it's just better at doing VR.
If the point of VR is immersion, yes. Then that would follow logically, I guess.
Okay, gotcha. That's interesting. So, and then the other point of that being, the Oculus can't really have changed that much between like the DK2 and the consumer version, right?
The resolution is going to be
higher resolution,
much better.
Okay, so that would be a big selling point too. Then maybe is the resolution perhaps like the center issue then?
No, probably the fact that when you put it on, you have like motion tracking controllers that you can move around the room with.
Okay, well yeah, that would do it.
Those are coming with the Oculus, but those are going to be separate later. Like they're in development right now, essentially. They're not fully finished.
Pre-orders got an option to join a line where they'd be notified that they could then pre-order the whatever they're calling them, the touch things.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, for now, for anybody that can't afford $600 like I can't, I went out and got myself this little nifty $100 headset right here. This is the Gear VR, and if you haven't seen the Gear VR, this is what it looks like, but more to the point, it's really, really, really good. Especially for $100. So this is probably the easiest recommendation, like purchase recommendation that I've made in a long time. It works so well, and I was so blown away by that. So, well, okay, let me put it on so I can look like an idiot.
I'm so ready for this.
I can't hear you, so you can freely ridicule me. So there you go.
Look at those eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
with the
my
phone
God.
In here, it looks a lot less weird, and then you've got your cover on there.
No, it still looks probably pretty weird, but yeah, you can just see your eyes blown up. It's great.
Oh, really?
You just nice. Put your phone in there?
You look like you got googly my God. Eyes.
Yeah, you look like a freaking arts and crafts store project right now.
You look like Bubbles from Trailer Park Boys in the future.
Bear, you got to take pictures of yourself wearing that and use them for thumbnails and YouTube videos.
Yeah, that was amazing.
Like hundreds of them.
So the Gear VR is $100, and when I first put it on, it wasn't like a whoa, this is crazy, but you know it was pretty surreal because I didn't expect to actually feel like I was there, you know, and that's something that people have been sort of trying to describe a lot, you know, like journalists and people that have been reviewing the Oculus and all this VR technology. They're trying to find the way to explain how it feels, and I think it's impossible because you sort of just have to do it in order to understand it. But it actually creates that sensation that you're somewhere else, which is something that I was really not expecting from a $100 piece of equipment. So I'm super satisfied with it. Obviously, it requires some high-end technology with your actual phone. So unless you have, I think it's a Galaxy S4 or better.
It's Android only, right?
Yeah, it's Android only. You can't do it with an iPhone either. So you...
Right.
Well, the thing is, too, like, so it's... It's a very specifically designed product, right? So you've got this exact space where a phone is supposed to fit in. So, you know, like it's designed exactly for the four phones that use it. But because of that, I think it was able to be a better product. So I sort of, I can appreciate that, I guess. But
what do you do with it?
Well, me primarily, I've been using it to watch movies and watch Twitch. So it's got this feature built into it where you can browse between theaters that you want to sit in. So you can sit in like a home theater or a cinema theater or a theater on the moon or an ant theater where you're like this miniature person that's sitting on a pencil underneath some mushrooms. And it sounds silly, but that's actually like one of the coolest fucking things I've ever experienced.
And that's when you eat some mushrooms and then you put it on. And you,
I love is that, it real you love life?
It's so cool, man. I can't get
Alice
over
in
it.
Wonderland.
I have some... J. Smith OTI childlike wonder about this product, man. It's
get a
cool.
VR headset so I can pretend to be an ant sitting on a fucking pencil watching Twitch. Watching a dude sitting in a chair playing a video game.
The future is now.
It's so immersive.
This is beautiful.
Here, does this device do anything other than hold your phone, or is it just a piece of plastic with a hole in
so
the
I
end
am,
of it?
I'm going to get to some real selling points here. So I played some games on it because I knew we want to talk about some games, and I've got some good ones. I played Esper, which is a game. It's a first-person game, surprisingly. It's a puzzle game that takes place entirely in one room, and you are using your mind to maneuver objects around, which is probably like the simplest premise we possibly could have thought of when we were thinking about VR games. But it also works pretty well, so that one was pretty good. And then there's a free one called Smash Hit, which is it sort of acts like, I think,
a tech demo.
A tech demo, yeah, exactly. So it works really well too, though. So you just move on rails through a hallway, and there are some diamonds and some various shapes that provide you with new metal balls that you fire with the little button on the side. And,
oh, it has a button.
Yeah, there's a button on the side. It's got a little touchpad. So you navigate with that, you swipe around. It's sort of like a laptop touchpad, but it's got a little button in the center of it, too.
Yeah.
And that one was a lot of fun. And I found myself going back and playing that over and over. So it's I've been really enjoying it. Oh, and then there was the final one, too. This is Land's End, I think is what it was called. And that's more of just like an exploration one, but the ones that create the full 3D environments are my favorites because they have a lot of attention to detail because the space that they have to work with is very limited. So like in Esper, for example, the room looked awesome and it felt realistic and it felt like the spacing made sense and everything. It's so crazy because you don't have to think about that stuff normally when you're playing a game, right? You don't consider the idea that, oh, yeah, they really put this desk far enough away from me for me to feel like I'm actually there. Like, that's not ever something I've had to analyze. So it's really impressing me. And I'm looking forward to the future of it because if this $100 thing that I bought at Best Buy on a whim is of this quality, then I'm pretty optimistic about the other things. And that's my Gear VR gush.
Can you imagine one day we're all just sitting at an actual round table, people can put on their VR headsets and they can look out of our eyes at each other?
Okay, that too. I wish so badly that there was a way to do like multiplayer versions of that, because the only thing I wanted to do as soon as I got into that fucking ant theater was say to my wife, babe, you gotta come in here. This is the coolest thing, but you know, that doesn't really work that way now.
Maybe soon, though.
Yeah.
I feel like we're on our way there.
The way I think about this, though, is kind of like when people were like, yo, dog, now that the internet and 3D games are like a big thing, what if you could enter like a 3D chat room that was like a world where you could walk around and interact with people? And that was like the height of what the future of socialization was going to be like.
Yeah.
And we're here like 10 years past the point where that could have happened. And outside of like MMOs, I guess, this is not the way it worked out at all. Just nobody gives a shit about it. That's kind of like, I don't think the watershed moment for VR can be, let's sit in a theater together and watch a movie.
Yeah, but it's so cool, man.
Well, I don't dispute that.
Best argument.
I know that really is the only argument I have. Like,
think
I know,
about
but I want
tabletop sim and how fun that could be to get three friends together and actually play with shit on a board game together at a table.
Yeah,
virtual
definitely.
Table. That's doable.
Those are all. Yeah, it's like Ryan said though. Like, that's it's not what is driving VR. You know, is the idea that we can all get together because we realize that we don't really actually want to share the virtual space with each other. We just want to be in different rooms using Let's Go to Meeting or something like that. But yeah, it's very. It really is giving me an optimistic mindset about VR because the experiences I had, I've mentioned to you guys a couple of times, I had some sort of suboptimal experiences with VR before that. Like, I had a couple of Oculus experiences that left me sort of thinking, oh, yeah, you know, that's kind of neat, but it's not really the immersion or the groundbreaking technology that I was sort of coming to expect from this experience. So it's left me with a much better taste in my mouth now.
Like, I should Mathis point out, like, with the Oculus, like, whenever I say, like, hey, $600 is, like, a little bit too expensive for me to buy in, the inclination seems to be like, well, you know, if you were to buy two 1440p monitors that run at that run at that frequency, it would cost you this. And like, you already need like a $2,000 PC, so $600 isn't that much. Like, you don't need that explanation right now. It's like a Mercedes costs like 80 grand, and there's a lot of engineering and hard work and handiwork that goes into it, but it's still too expensive for me.
Yeah, if you were going to build a fucking Mercedes yourself, that would still be pretty pricey, man. You got to recognize that.
So I'm like, I'm very optimistic about VR, and I'm confident that the consumer-grade Oculus will be like a cool product, but I still need something a little bit more to push me over the edge. Because I think, like, for me, I would put it on and be like, I'm like in the game, cool. But I need like my Wii Bowling to be like, this is a kind of a proof of concept that this works.
Oh, I don't want to just. You need like the game that sells it.
I need
for
the killer app
much.
For VR. Mm-hmm. I can't just like put it on and be like, I'm on a roller coaster.
Okay,
that make roller coasters make me vomit in the VR.
Yeah. I'm also
just so excited.
About that, but.
Like the whole potential of it for me has me just giddy. So like, I almost don't even care what they're trying to give to me for a game. I know there's gonna be stuff, and I want to be in for it as soon as possible.
I'm pumped for it too, definitely. Now that I actually got like a really good video card, I'm actually eager to plug in my DK2 again, and like try out some of the stuff that didn't run very well.
I wanted to ask you about that, Mathis. Yeah, because that's sort of. Something I've been worried about with this purchase, which luckily it hasn't happened for me yet, the idea of just sort of getting sick of it and setting it to the side and forgetting about it. And, well, has that happened for you with the Oculus, more or less?
No, I never got sick of it. The problem was that my card... Okay, so, like, as we discussed, the Oculus and I'm assuming the Vive and all that stuff is going to require kind of a beast of a machine to run it.
Mm.
I was running an i7-4790K... and a 780 GTX when I initially got it.
Yeah, those are numbers.
Yeah, those are numbers. Like a 780 GTX, like NVIDIA card, it was pretty good.
A good processor, like, a good video card, if you're unfamiliar.
And I was still struggling with some games because of the way it needs to kind of filter through motion detection and all that stuff. I was still not hitting the frame rate that you kind of need to not feel sick or like brought out of the experience and stuff. Some games, on the other hand, were fine. So the reason I put it away is because games like Elite Dangerous, the one that I loved playing on my headset, it was an incredible experience. But once I left like a starport and I was out in space and like fighting, it would judder. It would like it blur. It would just not 100% there. Mm. So I had to put it down because I was gonna. All the games that I wanted to were making me vomit.
Yeah.
So I'm excited because, you know, looking at the specs and stuff. Now that I have my 980 in there, I'm really pumped to plug in my DK2 again and really experience those high-end games in the DK. Mm-hmm. I'd be curious what it's going to be like. But the bottleneck was very much the video card, though. Like, my processor is still pretty high-end. Like, the processor that I have still goes for, like, $300 or $400. It was the video card that was holding it back.
So that is something I should mention as well that you just reminded me of. It's a lot more noticeable when you have those sorts of issues in VR.
It's really noticeable.
And it really destroys it for you, too. Like, almost instantly, it completely breaks the immersion, and you think, oh, geez, yeah, that fucked with my head. It must just be the proximity of the screen to your eyes because, you know, it doesn't look like it's even necessarily that bad. It'll be like a vertical tear here or there that'll, you know, all of a sudden completely... shatter the screen for half a second and then move things right back to where they were.
It completely destroys the experience.
It's just like your brain goes crazy. So that is an unfortunate side effect of it, but you know, it's, I guess, something that just sort of comes with the territory, right, as far as that's concerned.
The other thing I'm a little nervous about, just being somebody who's really prone to motion sick, is games that require fast movement.
I thought you were getting sick right
now. Yeah,
you're
getting
sick. Sorry,
I'm prone. Just talking about
it. So prone.
Oh.
But like, there are some games that are like, if you're prone to motion sickness, just be weary because games like roller coasters or any fast moving thing, what I noticed is being on those things, getting up to the top of a hill, your body is like, because it's very confused, your mind is confused, so your body is expecting to feel that drop.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you go down, and you start moving, and your body doesn't feel that drop, but you still have the sinking feeling in your stomach.
You get that sensation still, yeah.
Yeah, and then like you're like, well, I'm not feeling the force, and it just it makes me really sick. Mm. If that's something you're prone to normally, like it's going to be worse on a virtual set because your body is not experiencing what it's expecting to experience. So you just like vomit, like, oh, I can't do it.
And even if you don't think you're that guy, you might be that guy when it comes to VR. I didn't think I was going to be that guy either, but it got me pretty bad a couple of times. Like I had to, well, you know, I figure it's probably a good idea to not stay in there for too long anyway, but I did have to take pretty frequent breaks.
We say that now in 10 years, we're all never going to freaking wake up.
we'll be wearing this shit like it's normal stuff, man. I saw a picture of a dude just enjoying a McDonald's McCafe.
Yeah.
Yo, dog, get on my mushroom. I'm watching an old episode of Scrubs.
Come join me on my mushroom.
Sticks really comfortable, man. I promise it's good. You haven't seen How I Met Your Mother until you've seen it on a mushroom.
We don't even fucking sit on the mushroom, okay? We sit on a stick, and it's under the mushrooms. There's a lot of them. It's a field of them, and it's beautiful. Fuck you.
This reminds me of, like, when you would have, like, Winamp in 2001, and you'd be like, yo, dog, what kind of visualizations you got hooked up there? What kind of
custom- I made those. I made the visualizations.
You did, too. I did it, too, man.
And you're like, yo, you wouldn't understand, man. The music just sounds differently when you set the mood with the visualizations.
You know in Indie Game the Movie when Phil Fish would sit with a monitor right in front of his eyes? That was me in, like, 2003 making Winamp visualizations.
Yeah. Yes.
I was just staring at the flashing
vizzes.
Lights.
I like you calling them vizzes. That's hip.
The vizzes.
Yeah.
I was just blasting Spine Shank, listening to that.
Blasting Spine Shank, making visits, man. Come hang out under my mushrooms.
It's a fucking future. Oh, man.
But there are definitely some things that really amplify the motion sickness. I don't know about you, Bear, but for me, another thing was like getting really close to a wall. I don't know if you can really do that, but if I get really close to a wall, like, and then like turning my head and stuff, and just the way the wall would, it made me vomit too. Mm.
Luckily, most of my experiences have either been sitting still or moving in a straight line. But I guess it's probably a completely different experience to just be playing on a PC, too. Because with these games, the games designed for the Gear VR, they're not really going to be, you know, well, actually, there might be a lot of the same offerings that are being made available on the Rift, too. But, you know, the difference being there's games being made for the PC that aren't being made for Oculus VR, right? So that's the difference.
My impression of the Gear VR from what I've heard is that as soon as you put it on, it puts the game on like a screen and you can look at your hand and see the controller and then play it like really far away. And you're like, man, it's like I've really got a controller in my hands right now.
Maybe. There's probably a couple games like that, but I haven't really. I wouldn't say that if you ask me now. That's about all I've got for VR. And now we can quickly touch on Revel Mode, which was a story that just came around today. Very specific story, may not impact too many generally gaming-enthused folks, but it is definitely worth noting. A new MCN, it appears, right? This is pretty much an MCN.
They're still under Maker. Still under Maker. Disney Maker-owned still.
Mm-hmm. It's Revel Mode. It's the new network curated by PewDiePie, Felix Kjellberg, for those of you who know him by his proper name.
Kjellberg.
Kjellberg.
I like you said Care Bear.
Care Bear.
Felix Care Bear. contains such notable YouTubers as Markiplier, Jacksepticeye, Quebblecop, Cinematose Ken, Dodger, and a few others as well. And, This is big simply because of the people in it. That alone is noteworthy. But I think just the fact that PewDiePie has made his own network is sort of the news story here, right?
I mean, we knew it was coming. Mm-hmm. The initial, the initial understanding a few months back was that he was going to be breaking from Maker and doing his own thing, but that is no longer the case. And I'm curious what the differences are going to be between like Polaris and his network. Primarily, I'm curious about splits and the offerings and what they're going to be doing with that.
Well, this is like the black credit card, right? This is like the...
This is the cream of the crop. I really do, yeah. This is like the cream of the crop, like highest, you know, grossing probably YouTubers, or best known YouTubers maybe. Right. So, yeah, I mean, what else do we really know about it other than that?
Well, that's the thing is that we don't know much. They are just now announcing it. But this is sort of what I wanted to ask. This is the question I wanted to ask a lot of times we see these networks pop up that are saying things like, we are going to, well, let's just take their words right out of their mouths. They're going to curate content, raise money for charity, and so much more. What is that?
So do what they've been doing and
so much more.
Yeah. So I'm pretty sure that means nothing because we've heard it before and we know what networks do and we know what they are for.
Yeah.
I have no idea what else they would be doing.
My guess is going to be probably a better split, whatever is in there. And I would assume that whoever's in there is going to be guaranteed managed.
Yeah.
So that'll be something big.
Yeah. Well,
and outside of that,
the thing about that too is like it's pretty easy to assume that of the people in there now, most of, if not all of them, are, you know, are already enjoying this status for the most part, like you described. They probably have, they're probably not even working on splits anymore. I imagine they've got something that's totally different. And then they're all managed, I'm sure. They're all multi-million subscriber YouTubers that all independently didn't need something like this. So obviously baseless speculation for the most part here, but it is just, it's interesting to think of where this may be going. Also,
well, I'm confused about it because it's still part of Maker.
Yeah.
Which is what Polaris is part of. Like, it's still under that umbrella. So what are they bringing to the table that Polaris does not?
They must have more creative control than they did prior.
They must,
otherwise,
right?
There's like, literally no other reason for them
done it. Yeah. I don't know. I'm curious.
No, that definitely makes sense.
I don't know. I don't really like to comment on it because there's so much unknown that we're just filling in the blanks.
Yeah.
And I think the blanks are being filled in based on assumptions that we have no actual knowledge of. And I worry that this is feeding perhaps a stereotype of the YouTubers involved that is not helpful.
What would that be?
Well, I don't know. Are they all multi-million subscribed YouTube channels?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Dodger doesn't have a million subscribers, does she?
No.
Like, I don't know. I just think we're kind of filling in the blanks here with a lack of information, and I wouldn't want to speculate about it. The stuff that I would want to speculate about is all inside baseball stuff, like, again, managed or what the CPM would be or stuff like that, but you know, I don't want to burn any bridges by coming across like I have a bad impression of the network without knowing anything about it at all.
So let's save face here by saying, hey, if any of you nine people are watching this video, we mean you all, no ill will whatsoever. We'd love to join your network.
This stuff is on the public record, man. Like, I don't know. I think it's, I'm not going to speculate on it.
That's fair.
We don't know anything. We don't gain anything by speculating.
It's just very interesting, you know?
If we're wrong, no one's ever going to call us on it. And if we're right, we get to say, like, oh, I told you so. I knew it.
Oh, that's worth it. That alone right there. That's the feeling we need. Now, I think just the simple fact that these are probably some of the most, if not the most influential people on YouTube right now. So it's definitely going to make waves. It already has, of course. This is a channel that just popped up today for Revel Mode that now has like 30,000 subscribers. So, you know, like they have the power to do a lot of stuff on YouTube. So it is certainly worth, in my opinion, you know, like investigating the possibilities here of what they could potentially be trying to bring to the table. I don't know if they're maybe even going for a little bit of a, like a liberation tactic perhaps for YouTubers who are caught in the deep, deep, depressing well of 60-40 RPM splits, you know? Like, maybe something like that's going on here. But, and yeah, it's also very true, as you mentioned, that wild speculation may not be the idea that we want to stick with.
99% of the time, in my perspective, the network that a channel is under has no effect on the content. So mm-hmm.
It's true, yeah.
Like, I mean, we had the same thing happen like a year and a half ago when Jetpack was started by CNanners and Vanoss and Syndicate.
Which, what happened to that?
It's still going.
Is it? Wow.
I don't want to like devote too much, I guess, attention to a news story that is probably going to be like, you know, they incorporated and now they're going to just basically be the MCN that other YouTubers continue to do business as usual under.
Fair enough. All right. Let's talk about Tharsis. It's new.
I really wish I could.
Oh, damn. What happened?
I just, it's the same. I tried to get into it a second time and my brain, I just couldn't parse how it worked. Like, the tutorial was too much info for me, and I just couldn't do it. So I actually watched today, I think I watched a little bit of Quill, a little bit of Ryan, and now I have a pretty solid understanding as to how Tharsis worked.
You didn't watch
it
me,
looked
though.
Cool.
I wanted to get an understanding
before
of it.
We
yeah.
Too far down that well.
Get into the what it is.
Sure, Tharsis is a turn-based space strategy game, dice-based for pretty much everything. The goal is to get your crew to Mars after an unexpected disaster hits and forces you to act on your feet. It's very difficult. That I think we can all agree on, right? It's a pretty tough game. Yeah, a lot of luck involved with it too, unfortunately. Overall, I am a pretty big fan, and I'm willing to let the luck stuff not even really let it slide necessarily, because I sort of feel like that's maybe a little bit of the appeal to it for certain people. And I think this one's going to be a little divisive as well, not necessarily between all the four of us, but with people in general for that reason, maybe alone. Feel free to take the win, though.
I can't say anything about it. My only complaint about it so far, out of the very little time that I put into it, is that the tutorial is just, and the UI is a little bit just, there's too much going on, and they don't do a very good job at like breaking it down for someone like me.
Yeah, for
someone like me who I have a hard time like comprehending without reading something 100 times, and if there's just a lot going on a screen, I just can't focus. So I couldn't figure it out.
I just couldn't
break into it.
I was that the first time I booted it up, and it took me a little while to get into it. But once I figured it out, it's pretty intuitive once you recognize what everything is on screen. And as you mentioned, they probably need a better tutorial to sort of give you a better idea of what actually is done with such things as the research projects and the individual modules. Make a little bit more sense when you've employed those tactics in a run. But yeah, I think that's definitely a knock on it that's valid.
I agree with that. I think it starts out a little inaccessible and kind of needlessly so, because it's pretty simple in its mechanics. Basically, what it does is just give you a lot of options. Mm. You know, people have been kind of reductively calling it Space Yahtzee, but that's pretty much what it is. Like, you roll dice, there's a category that's best to commit those dice to save your life or extend your life. If you can't commit to that, go down the flowchart. Like, do I have anything that can do this? Do I have anything that can do this? But it's, like, almost too much when you first see it. You're like, what is this research? Yeah. What is, like, character, my character class? What is growing food mean? And then the other thing I think about Tharsis, even though I quite like it, is that it seems like the cannibal stuff is kind of, like, shoehorned in.
Yeah, I was going to say that, too.
I agree. Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. 4 weeks
like
in.
Extreme a little bit. Like, it doesn't seem like it really needs to be there.
Edgy.
Yeah,
like, the marketing is like, you know, cannibals in space, but it's like, it doesn't really have to be cannibalism. It seems like kind of an arbitrary game mechanic, I guess, but that could also just be the way it's presented.
Yeah, I was actually just about to say a little bit of the presentation there, because there are just some gratuitous parts of it that exist solely for the idea of, oh, yeah, you terrible person, you ate another human being, what's wrong with you? But, overall, I think there's a few things like that I don't love as well. Like, the story, speaking of the word shoehorned, I don't know, like, especially near the end, I'm not going to spoil anything for what spoilers there might be, but it's definitely not the strongest part of the game. I think it's just sort of forgettable, you know? It's got a pretty classic sci-fi niche to it that doesn't really draw me in, so that was not my favorite aspect.
It's also weird for a game that mechanically seems focused on repeat playthroughs to have kind of a story that's set every time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like, in terms of story progression, I kind of feel like it would have worked better if it was similar to FTL, where there's kind of like a conceit at the start and a goal at the end, and then the stuff that happens along the journey is actually the emerging gameplay. Like, sometimes with the linear story cutscenes, you'll have like a really awesome week one and everyone will be fine and they'll be like, tempers are starting to flare. And I'm like, well, that doesn't reflect what happened.
Right.
Because I like, everything's under control. We're actually like better off now than we were at week zero. But I think it kind of cheapens the story that it tries to double dip in like being a story-based experience, but also something that's meant to be replayed over and over. Mm-hmm. If it is meant to be replayed over and over, which I feel like it is.
I think it's absolutely the strongest when you look at it from that perspective, of it being something that you can go back to and play for 45-minute to an hour sessions, which is, a genre that I am a big fan of, but also is a little, you know, oversaturated, and unfortunately a lot of the entries in that genre are not terrific. So I think I like this well enough simply because it is a game that executes its premise well and is very fun to play. I think it's a fun game to play, albeit with a little bit of rage-inducing luck that can sometimes not fall your way.
Yeah.
I've been really enjoying myself, though, enough to, you know, like, I started a series on it, so I'm obviously enjoying it to a certain extent, but it's, yeah, I've been having fun with it, and I like the, I like the balance especially. I think the balance is done pretty damn well. I think it it does a very good job of putting you in a whole bunch of positions through the course of a single playthrough that are very difficult decisions to make, which I think is something undervalued in games in whole.
I agree.
Like that, the ability to create a situation in a game that presents two options that are very difficult to choose between, that's really tough to do. That is extremely difficult.
So, and it's also risky, too, because if you get it wrong, you risk making a lot of players angry and potentially not have them return to doing what the decision would have been. So you want to take some power away, but not all of it.
Yeah.
I like the idea of it, too. Like, again, I'm speaking from a point where I've really barely scratched the tutorial, but one of the things that I was excited about when I got the email from them, they're like, it's a bit of FTL. So I went in with an idea of, like, replayability, random encounters, but when I, again, I haven't played much, but when I watched people play it and the little I played, it really does seem more heavily in favor of the RNG aspect than really your control. Your control just is limited to, all right, well, that's what RNG has given you. Yeah. What do you, where are you going to put
those
numbers?
Yeah, you mostly tamper with the result of RNG, right?
Right.
I actually
layers, too.
The thing about Tharsis is that I actually find interesting, and I'm interested to see where people fall on this, is I really feel like since where it really came up for me was like when Darkest Dungeon did its early access changes and people started treating like RNG as an objective flaw in game design, like reliance on RNG. So in Tharsis, there's no getting around it. You're like literally physically rolling dice on the screen and then committing those results. But I actually like that. Like that doesn't bother me at all. And I accept that, you know, sometimes that means I'll do better than I should, because I've rolled and it compensated for my shitty decisions. Or sometimes I'll play perfectly but still lose as a result of the RNG. And that's part of the fun for me. But I'm interested to know where other people kind of fall on that issue.
I think the problem with Darkest Dungeon initially was that the RNG aspects were kind of introduced over time, if I remember correctly. A lot of people were getting mad because the game initially, when it was released, there was RNG involved, but there was more player control. And then they started introducing like the dead bodies thing and all this other stuff that introduced more RNG aspects to the game that took control away from the player that was previously there. Where Tharsis, it's built in. So I don't have a problem with it. I think my point was that they marketed it to me in a way that was like, you like FTL, you'll probably like Tharsis. And I think they're just totally separate games. I really don't think there's any comparison there.
I wanted to mention that, too. I definitely got a lot of people telling me, if you like FTL, you'll like Tharsis. But I sort of fail to see that comparison, apart from the setting and maybe a little bit of the gameplay.
The way it's structured is a little FTL-like, but the actual gameplay and the decisions you make are not really FTL-like.
No, I would agree.
You could probably
like
spin
marketing
it.
Speak. To me. Yeah, like, yeah. It's just sort of broad strokes. It's like, hey, it's in space, there's RNG, it's a spaceship, and things are going wrong. It's very broad.
It's like evocative enough, I guess. But I don't know like what else you would market it as. Because you either say that or you have to be like, it's a digital representation
of a board
Yahtzee,
game. Or you say it's Space Yahtzee, right.
Exactly. You'd be like, well, it's Yahtzee in space. And people will be like,
I don't even think it's wrong that they use that to represent it, because it did give you enough of the flavor that you can figure out the rest, and the game is strong enough on its own that when you realize it's not really like FTL, you're not mad about it, because it's still its own thing. Right.
But like you said, though, that requires you at least investing that initial amount of time, which is going to be a tough sell when the idea is Space Yahtzee, right?
That's why they got to get the tutorial sorted out, because I felt like Mathis, in that it seemed really confusing. There was so many variables you needed to learn.
There's just things popping up like all over the place. I'm like, I don't know where to look.
I don't think it's not able to be managed, for sure. Like, after three or four games, I kind of got the idea. But at first, you're like, here's four characters. They all have their traits. There's a ship with different parts that are all kind of on fire sometimes, but like, what's breaking in them, and what does it mean if I fix them?
And the thing about it too is you're supposed to be panicked in that stage, right? So you're going into the game in mostly a panicked state, and if you don't understand entirely what you're doing, then it's gonna be pretty easy to get turned off to it as a new player.
They also push a sense of urgency at the beginning, which there isn't actually. It's actually turn-based. Nothing happens until you tell it you're done.
Right.
That reminded me of what was the name of that point-and-click game?
Gods
Will Be Watching.
Yeah.
I remember the same problem happened for me when I initially played Gods Will Be Watching. I was like in a panic. I'm like, I gotta get this shit done.
Right.
And then you realize it's turn-based. You're like, oh, there's not a lot of panic going on right now.
I think Gods Will Be Watching is actually a really good comparison. Not only because of the way that it's kind of structured and being turn-based, but because in the way that you could play optimally and still get screwed by RNG, which I brought it up as a direct comparison because I love Gods Will Be Watching, but a lot of people whose opinions I really respect were like, this game is hot trash because RNG can fuck you. It's just kind of interesting, I guess, how people kind of split along the line.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it's very rewarding, but also some balance sometimes should be introduced. Otherwise, you just get frustrated. I mean, that's really the only... I didn't feel like there was so much power ever given to me that it eventually wasn't all going to be taken away later by RNG. I mean, there were certain games where I started and I was in a really good position compared to 90% of the other times, which seems like, okay, so why don't I just spam reset until I find a good starting run? Otherwise, I'm already dooming myself by turn four, right?
I like RNG in a game, but I'm with Nick where, like, if you're going to introduce RNG, you have to introduce a mechanic where you can deal with bad RNG. It's going to be hard, it's going to be challenging, but I don't want RNG to completely end your game. I think that is where I personally draw the line. I hate where a game is like, RNG fucked you, there's nothing you can do, haha, play again. I'm okay with the game being like, RNG just made this 100 times more difficult, but it's still possible if you play well. And I think Isaac, you know, I know we use that example a lot, but Isaac is one of the games that's done it the best where RNG can fuck you really hard, but if you keep playing and you play well, you can still succeed.
And I do believe there is some of that in this game, by the way. I think there's enough depth and strategy that as you start to unravel the layers of it, you realize there's more control than you think you have. But I'm not entirely all the way there yet.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I think it's easy to forget that there are strategies that you can take that they might not seem like it, but they do give you a degree of control over the RNG, or at least influence. Like, giving your units more dice, that gives you a better chance of actually hitting the rolls that you want. And, you know, committing to stuff like food to give them more dice, or having the class that gives you more rerolls, or using your pilot class in a module to give an extra reroll to the other units that come into that module. Like, those are strategies that do mitigate RNG, even if, you know, the response is like, well, you're just throwing another dice. Well, it's true, yeah, but the extra dice is another chance to get to the point that you need to get to, I guess.
I mean, Blood Bowl is the most RNG game I play and tolerate. It's nonsense because I still feel like Blood Bowl gives enough control over player positioning where you can mitigate RNG to a degree where maybe Tharsis is still pretty RNG heavy.
Yeah.
But I think if it is over the line, it's only over by a tiny bit, and I'm not even sure if it is over.
That's what it seems like. That's what it seems like. Yeah. I'm not saying it's bad. I can't give you an opinion. I haven't played enough.
One of the things I thought when I was playing is that as like a single player experience, I think it's pretty good. I probably like it more than the average, but more than the average person, not more than the average game necessarily.
Right.
But I think what would be really cool is I almost thought it was like Forbidden Island, where if they had like a tabletop version and everybody played one of the classes, and it like those would be like quick like tabletop turns. We could like advise each other on what to do.
Yeah,
that seems like a really cool like engaging way to play it.
Yeah, it makes me think of like the Battlestar Galactica game a little bit. But yeah, so like fun. You said with co-op version of it. Somebody tweeted that I think at me today. That was a good idea. Somebody should make that. If they can make a This War of Mine board game, they can make a Tharsis board game. Make it happen.
That's somebody said they might be thinking about considering doing that, maybe.
I hope they do.
That's enough qualifiers there.
Absolutely, yeah. let's go to the next game, though. Let's talk about Punch Club. It's the new one from Tiny Build, developed by Lazy Bear Games. I like that. Punch Club is basically Game Dev Tycoon with fighting. Is that fair?
That's exactly how I pitch it to people who are like, what is it like? I'm like, it's Game Dev Tycoon with boxing and a branching storyline.
Yeah. And it's fun, it's wacky, but you know, it's not like jazz punk wacky. It's sort of a more of like a self-aware humor, I think. There's a lot of very obvious references scattered throughout it, and I think it...
No, the game is cramped-packed with obvious references.
Yeah, it's sort of just egregious, almost. There's a dude behind the bar who is dressed like Brad Pitt named Tyler who quotes Fight Club.
Man. Oh. No, it's true. There's Casey is a pizza owner, I believe, from Ninja Turtles. You've got... Mm-hmm. Apu from The Simpsons is in there. There's Ninja Turtles references. Yeah. There's Jay and Silent Bob references at the convenience store.
What I can appreciate is that 95% of the references are stupid enough that I can understand them. So I feel like I really understand a lot of the humor in this game. So I have played... Let me actually check because it's sort of embarrassing.
I thought we as a society were against memes in games. It was the thing everybody held against Guacamelee, and now I see people being like, you know...
People hate Guacamelee? Maybe I'm just out of the loop.
People hate Guacamelee for the memes.
I love Guacamelee.
I didn't know that.
When I was talking about it, people were like, yeah, but there's like a troll face in the background. But then like, Casey Jones is the pizza owner?
Yeah.
These guys get me.
I have no problems. Bring on the memes, man.
Leonardo is punching the main character in the face in the Steam image for the game. So, I don't know. They probably wear it on their sleeve a little bit. So, I've got 8 hours in Punch Club. And
you more than me.
Yeah, I'm addicted. I think it has the exact...
Have you beaten it at all?
No, I've... I started off... There are three distinct skills, or stats, I should say, that you can level up in Punch Club. There is your strength, your agility, and your endurance. So, the game suggests that you focus on one... And sort of let your other ones, you know, like build up slowly along with them. So you can either focus on strength, agility, or endurance. I started out as strength, mostly because the path for strength is called the Way of the Bear, and I had to be honest with myself.
Right.
I went about 100 days into that, and I very quickly realized that that was the incorrect choice. And I'm pretty sure there's just a correct choice in this game, and it's agility.
Agility mm-hmm. is what I heard, yeah.
And it's sort of disappointing. Because that's I was loving the game up to the point where I realized, oh, agility is just sort of the best. And there's not really, there's not really a way to argue it. What was your experience with it, though, Mathis?
So you've played it way more than me, but I really enjoyed Game Dev Tycoon, and I like that managing, and there's something very satisfying about watching bubbles go up to your little bars and stuff.
Yeah.
But what I like about it personally, outside of like the stat management, and there's a lot of skills you can choose from, you can really kind of customize your fighter pretty well, is the branching storyline. Like, that's my favorite part. I like that I can go, like, it's a very... very generic story opener. You know, your dad was a boxer, he gets shot by some skeezy guy, now you're trying to be a boxer and like avenge him or whatever. What I like is like you can become the professional boxer, or you can be under, and you're all laughing at something.
I pulled up your video of your Punch Club
let it play?
Well,
you see me
it's playing
thing?
And what's hilarious is you're wearing the exact same shirt.
Oh.
You're up here on the top bar going like talking about all this stuff with your hands, and then down on the top right corner of your Fight Club video or your Punch Club video, it's you doing the exact same thing.
Anyway, what I like that you can be like a professional boxer, you can be like an underground boxer, or you can be like a street fighter, and they all have different stories and stuff. That's like my favorite part of the game. I enjoy that.
Agreed.
Shadow boxing? Yeah, that's what I was doing. Shadow boxing. I was teaching.
He's practicing, right.
I haven't played the release build of Punch Club, but I played the PAX build at home. It was like a half hour long. Mm. And I played the same PAX build at PAX like a week later, and I really don't think it's for me.
Mm-hmm.
Admittedly, have not played the release build, but my impression from the PAX demo was that it was less like Game Dev Tycoon and much more like a dating sim, basically, where you're like, you're not trying to court people, but it's like, okay, I'm going to use my resource to go to, almost like a visual novel, but not as linear, I guess. Like, I'm going to use my limited time resource to go to the grocery store now, and I'm going to buy a hamburger and eat it. That's going to give me the fuel to run on this treadmill for like 30 seconds, and then I'm going to go to sleep. And then tomorrow, you know, my energy will be recharged, and I'm going to, you know, do the same thing, basically. And it did not resonate, like, with my sense of humor at all. I was like, my dude ate a burger out of the trash can and, like, hallucinated and fought a Teenage Mutant Ninja crocodile. And I was like, yeah, I know who the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles are, but, like, it's not, like, for me, I guess it's not inherently funny.
Well,
not
it's, that it's not laugh out loud funny. It's that sort of like, ah, okay, funny.
It's a Ninja Turtle.
Yeah.
It's not for me, I think.
Hmm. The gameplay is just so inherently addicting. Like, I start and then I can't stop, which is clearly a good sign for it. Also, of course, the whole spectacle behind Punch Club was the Twitch Plays Punch Club promotional event that they did, which I was thinking about that as they put it up, and wouldn't it just be the worst thing in the world if they ran that and nobody played it? It just sat on Twitch, like 1 to 2 viewers desperately trying to get through the game. No one else cared. So I'm glad that people actually latched onto that for Tiny Build's sake, because that would have been terrible. Also, speaking of Tiny Build, like, good God, they are killing it recently with their promotions. They're announcing 4 new games in 4 days right now. I think they just announced the second of 2, and they've got 2 more on the way. These aren't just like little, fucking itch.io games that they put up. Like, these are full-fledged, no disrespect to itch.io, but they're like actual, you know, games that they're announcing, and it's just kind of crazy that they've got 4 at that stage, so kudos to them.
I'm questioning whether or not I should even say it, but like, I don't really like anything that they've done that much except for Speedrunners.
Speedrunners, yeah.
Like, and I'm not trying to shit on them as a publisher. I think they do a lot of good for indie games, and like, they're very developer friendly from what I've heard. And I'm happy that, you know, Punch Club has done well. I think they marketed it very cleverly and a lot of people like it. You have 8 hours in it. But like, Party Hard, I feel like, had kind of the same thing where it was like marketed well, and for like 3 days people were like, Party Hard's pretty fun, and then it just fell off. And like, I will say the train game that they announced, like the post-apocalyptic train
Final
survival
Station.
Game. It looks cool. But everybody's losing their shit, and I'm like, I don't know. I don't know that I've hit that point for Tiny Build yet. I really like them as a publisher, but compared to the pedigree of something like... it's not even fair to like compare publishers like this, but when I see like Devolver's coming out with something, I'm like, okay, that's probably going to be interesting. Mm-hmm. When I see that Tiny Build's coming out with something, I don't have that reaction yet.
That's fair.
But
yeah, Devolver just has a better track record,
yeah.
That's all.
That's my philosophy.
I completely agree with everything you said. Like, all of it.
Yeah, it's kind of hard not to. I mean, just looking back at Tiny Build's list, I mean, you've got No Time to Explain, which was, you know, okay. Spoiler Alert, which was sort of universally panned. You got a few games that I've never even heard of. Divide by Sheep, which...
That game was actually pretty good.
Yeah, okay, there you go.
I'll be the one guy who played that math-based puzzler. It was pretty good.
I heard it was math-based, and I kind of was, like, not into it.
It has to do with the...
Probably why I didn't touch it.
Tell me all about Human Resource Machine, man.
Oh, dude, Human Resource Machine is awesome.
That's what I heard.
If you actually want me to tell you all about it, I will. But I'll give you an out in case there was a challenge.
Whatever, man. You can give me a 1.5-minute spiel on Human Resource Machine.
You're late, Jacksepticeye.
I'll give you a video, even. How about that?
Human Resource Machine is basically a game in which you manipulate boxes and then send them to an outbox that simulates... programming logic. So basically, you grab a little bit of data, manipulate it within the physical environment of the game, and then send it to the outbox. You're basically building a machine that does that for you.
Mm-hmm. And you like it a lot.
It's very satisfying, yeah. It's one of the few puzzle games that has made me feel like a genius, because I have a little bit of built-in programming knowledge, I guess. So when I played it, unlike most puzzle games, I was like, my head is already here. Like, I know exactly how to do what you want me to do.
I could hear that in your voice as I was watching your video, by the way. Just like the level of excitement you genuinely had for, oh, this makes sense to me because of my knowledge. And I only contrast that with the approach I had to it, which was none of this makes any sense whatsoever.
Yeah, Human Resource Machine is pretty cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. And then I'm playing TIS 100 right now,
which is
Human Resource Machine, but for geniuses. And I'm like three puzzles deep and like can't do anything.
Nick looks like he's exhausted hearing about
it. No, I'm thinking back of Space Chem, because it's like I wanted so badly to love that game, and I really did, but I'm too stupid to play it.
Space Chem is real tough.
That's a tough feeling.
Human
to
Resource
swallow,
Machine
isn't it?
Is like the same way you don't need to be like a structural engineer to play World of Goo. I think it's kind of the same for Human Resource Machine, is that, you know, you get into the language pretty quickly, but TIS 100 is like you need to know what you're doing.
Human
to some
Resource
extent.
Machine reminded me of my programming days and just gave me PTSD, and I couldn't touch it. Oh. I hate programming. I hate programming so much.
You're missing the artistry, man.
I am aware, but my brain does not. I hated it. Nope.
Thank you. Back to Punch Club, I guess, real quick. Anything left to say about that one? I think.
Let me just say one thing, which is that I don't inherently have a negative bias towards Tiny Build.
Mm-hmm.
I just, like, I think that because of the reaction that I've had to a couple of games that they come out recently, I'm kind of like, what's the big deal? Like, yeah. Whenever they announce something and I see Twitter go nuts, I'm like, I guess it just is passing me by for whatever reason right now. But I still, like, if something comes in the inbox from Tiny Build, I know that it's at least reputable.
Yeah.
Like, it's not like I'm like, oh, fucking Tiny Build game, you know.
Yeah.
It's just none of them, at least since Speedrunners, has really kind of grabbed me the same way.
I think with this game in particular, you're sort of nailing it when you say, this will probably occupy my time for another few days, and then I'll never play it again.
Dude, I'm amazed that you have 8 hours at a Punch Club. That's cool.
I like it a lot. But
8 hours is where you cross the threshold of, like, I'll play this game for a while into, like, I'm actually enjoying playing this, mm-hmm. and it's not like a chore. That's like a whole night.
Yeah, no, definitely. I'm having a really good time with it, but I am very aware of the fact that I will get to a point where I decide, okay, yeah, this is, I've had my fill of this experience. But I know, actually, that there's a lot more beyond what I've played. And I've sort of maybe even given myself a good opportunity to elongate the amount of time that I spend in this game artificially by starting a new file and just going agility heavy. I actually, so the first character I made was the biggest piece of shit because the entire strategy he had was go for the knees as hard as you can. So just fucking destroy their limbs. And they won't be able to fight you back.
Jesus.
So I really wouldn't have wanted to run into my fighter.
Some of those boxers are cheaters, man. I was fighting one and he kicked me and I'm like, that's bullshit.
That's bullshit, dude. That's not how this works. You have to go to the underground ring for that.
Yep.
So you get your kicks in. Those are the only people I could fight because I'd just destroy their kneecaps. yeah, that's Punch Club. I highly recommend it. I think personally I can say this is a lot of fun to play. If you liked Game Dev Tycoon even a little bit, you're probably going to like Punch Club.
Mm.
Nick, any final thoughts?
I actually didn't play it. All right. I only got it like the day before you said we were going to talk about it on the show, so I didn't play it yet.
Fair enough. Right. You should play it. I think it's a good one.
All right.
$10 available now. Also, Tharsis, I think I failed to mention the price tag on that one. It's $15?
10 for opening week and then 15 afterwards, yeah.
Okay, cool.
And I will say at $15, I think that's probably a little pricey for Tharsis.
Yeah?
10 seems nice. 15 is like, yeah. I would hesitate to recommend it to someone who's on the fence.
Okay.
Oh, guys, we got to talk about Assassin's Creed Chronicles.
No, we don't.
India?
No, we don't, man.
It's mostly positive reviews, man.
We honestly, I'm pretty sure we are on a streak of talking about Assassin's Creed in the show.
Every episode.
It's probably 5 weeks
it's
long.
It's in the news, man. They're newsmakers.
It's crazy. They released a new game. A new Assassin's Creed game came out yesterday.
Is it like made for PC or is it?
Yeah,
it's like a port.
So this is part 2 of 3 of the Chronicles series, which is going to be in China, India, and Russia. What's the third one? I don't know. The first
are
one.
Are they going for the largest countries on Earth? Because
it's a smart joke. I understood it, though. See, I know geography as it pertains to the top 3 countries by landmass. You can get me on those jokes.
Canada's number 2, but damn it. One day.
Assassin's Creed Canada?
There you
That's
go.
Gonna happen one day.
I don't even want to acknowledge this, man. It's just, it's another, well, it's the second of the three 2.5D Assassin's Creed games. So that's what this one is.
Dude, when Nick linked that to me, That's probably the most Nick-ish I've ever gotten about watching like gameplay footage or something.
What does that even mean?
Because I saw
does that mean? What do you think of me?
The assassin
dude. We're getting into a deep hole, man.
The assassin dude snuck up on a guy, all sneaky like, jumped up, kicked him in the back, did a backflip, then pulled out his sword and stabbed him through the chest. And I was like, why wouldn't they just stab him through the back when he snuck up on him? And that
being practical about it, right?
If Nick had said that, I'd be like, Nick, it's for style points, right? But I was like, this doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
It's like to make something stylish, it just completely like betrays the essence of the game, which is, I guess, stealth action. But wasn't China? It was like mediocre.
No, yeah, I didn't even like it. I didn't like it at all. It was just, I don't want to play that Assassin's Creed game, and I really don't want to play Assassin's Creed Chronicles India, nor do anyone else, apparently. It's got 40 reviews on Steam so far, and the description, I believe, is in Italian. So
yeah, I really don't know why there's so little English on that description.
Yeah. So that's interesting.
Very little English.
So Chronicles China has a mixed review. Mm-hmm. Right now, India has mostly positive. We'll see how fast that drops.
Yeah.
What are the Steam Spy stats on the new one?
Have a look.
Would they be up yet?
While you figure that out for me, I'm going to go ahead and introduce everybody to everyone's favorite segment. It is Ask Roundtable.
Ah.
You can send in questions to Ask Roundtable by emailing them to roundtableyt@gmail.com. Every week we answer a new question. We do our best to answer as many as we can. This week's question comes from Kirk. He says, loving the podcast so far. Love your YouTube channels, but enough with the pleasantries. It's question time. A few weeks ago, you answered what your favorite game from your favorite genre was. That made me curious as to what your favorite game from your least favorite genre is.
Your favorite game in your least favorite
your
genre?
Your favorite game from your least favorite genre. So I think, first of all, we have to determine what our least favorite genres are. So let's go around. I'd say mine are probably sports games.
Sports games.
Sports games.
What is my least favorite genre?
Dude, I think my least favorite genre is probably, like, simulators. But I don't want to be like... Well, my favorite simulator is like Euro Truck Sim. I have like 50 minutes in it. Mm. Like so I'll take maybe a genre that is like not my least favorite, but I don't normally like that much. I'll say like, I'm going to say first person shooters and RPGs.
Shit. Okay. I'll just say first person shooters. That's it.
Okay.
Okay. So what's your favorite first person shooter then?
Well, of all time, I don't really know. But recently, I was just taking this as an opportunity to talk about Rainbow Six Siege, which continues to be a lot of fun asymmetrical multiplayer in spite of its problems. And the problems are largely related to Uplay, which sucks. But it's made me play more of a AAA first-person shooter than any game since, like, a long time. Like Halo 2, maybe? There you go, so. Yeah. We're way back, like 11
you
years.
Say Fallout 4, man. Fallout 4 is a first person.
Oh, that's true. That is true. I did play a lot of Fallout 4, actually. But Titanfall, probably since Titanfall, yeah. But for the most part, I like ignore every AAA first person shooter. But I'll go to bat for Siege. I could see myself playing like an hour of Siege a night for like 6 months for sure.
You're just trying to get us back into it.
I'm still into it. I'll be right here. That's E.T. That's
another one I got.
I'm always on at night playing Siege. A little bit too late for the ESP.
Play some Warframe, man.
I'm not going to go back to Warframe, probably. So.
All right, Mathis, least favorite your favorite first-person shooter, which is your least favorite.
I will say I like Rainbow Six Siege a lot, but I think my favorite first-person shooter has to be, I put so many hours into it, was Halo 2. Halo 2 was, like, back in my heyday, like, I wasn't as good as you were, Bear.
Oh, but you're goddamn right you were.
I was, like, that was my go-home-and-play game. That, I played a lot of Ghost Recon. I played a lot of multiplayer Ghost Recon.
Advanced
on the original. On the original Xbox.
Oh, was okay, way back.
Island Thunder?
Yes, Island Thunder. That is actually correct.
Or Island something.
I always see this one match that I have like a fond memory of. But I played a lot of that, and I played a lot of Halo 2. Those are like the two games I probably put a ton of time into.
Nice. What do we got, Nick?
Well, first of all, I want to just say that I don't see any stats for the new Assassin's Creed Chronicles. I don't think it seems to be up yet.
Okay. However, it was released yesterday, so that's to be expected, I guess.
The older one has several thousand people playing it every day, which surprised the shit out of me.
Wow, yeah. That is startling,
actually. Anyway, my least favorite genre is probably sports games. My favorite game within that genre, I'm going to say, is probably WWF Attitude.
Whoa.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Was that the one where it's like... that?
Yeah. I was not arcade. It was really arcade and cartoonishy.
It was super cartoonish, and it heavily emphasized creative fighter, wrestler.
Oh, sorry. I was thinking of a different one. This is like a PS1 era.
PS1 and 64. Yeah, I had it on 64, and I really enjoyed beating the shit out of like Violent J and Shaggy 2 Dope, because you could like make the clown makeup properly, and you could make like all manner of ridiculous shit in that game. And
Go ahead.
You could basically just make like superheroes if you wanted, or anything. Like just if you want to be a little creative.
Those games have always had amazing character editors, man. That's always been a staple of it.
I heard they're like super fun.
Yeah.
Have you ever played Legends of WrestleMania? Not Legends of Wrestling, But Legends of WrestleMania, the one that brings back like the WWE cast from like 20 years, and then is super arcadey, it's pretty good.
Oh boy. Oh, I've seen this box art actually. It's very eye-catching box art, very gold.
It doesn't play it straight. Like when Macho Man Randy Savage goes up for a flying elbow drop, he goes like 200 feet in the air. I mean,
then he lights on fire and shoots a laser.
All right. Well, for me, I'm going to go sports games. I originally was just going to say NBA 2K14 because that's the...
Which is what I expected.
Yeah. I talk about the embarrassing amount of hours I have in Punch Club. Let's talk about the embarrassing amount of hours I have in NBA 2K14, which I'm pretty sure we've already shamed me for, but it's 232. But when
what
Nick
you got
said...
Rocket
League probably is a little more, though. I hope it's more, because the more I play Rocket League and didn't cross 234 hours, the more I realized how much I was playing NBA 2K14. It was really sad. Okay, Rocket League, I've got 353, so that's looking a little better now.
Sensible.
I want to say NFL Blitz now, though. Now that Nick got me along the line of thinking, oh, yeah, sports games are a little bit more
things
broad
you
of a genre.
Things you can beat the shit out of people in.
Yeah, exactly.
NFL Blitz, transcend like, genre. Like 97.
Mm-hmm, the old school shit, man. The arcade cabinet one. That's what I'm talking about. Not even bringing it home. I got to go out to kick some ass on the football field.
The 2012 NFL Blitz was actually pretty good.
Yeah?
It was exactly the way they should have released it. It was like an Xbox Live Arcade $15 multiplayer NFL Blitz.
No, but it's not like the way they released NBA. Like,
exactly. NBA Jam.
Yeah, the $60... fully priced arcade game.
They took out being able to like power bomb people after the play was over, and then you're like, well, that's part of the fun.
not like Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 5, am I right?
Oh.
Does that count as a sports game?
Does it? Is that your new favorite?
No, I'm just saying like Tony Hawk in general. I played a hell of a lot
yeah,
more than
Attitude.
Yeah,
you call like Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2 and 3, maybe. But then 4 just stops being a sports game.
I'm looking at chat, and so I did play a metric fuck ton of Fight Night Round 3, actually.
Oh, me too.
I played so much.
I did play awesome. That quite a bit.
Oh, apparently I need to play Fight Night Round 3. Shit.
It was definitely the best one.
It was really good.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Kirk, for the question. That was a fun one to think about. I'm glad you asked it. So thank you very much, Kirk, for... sending that one in. If you have a question you'd like to ask us and have potentially answered on the show, email that to roundtableyt@gmail.com. And finally, time for everybody's favorite segment. After their favorite segment, it's Nick's Weird Games. Nick's Weird Games happens every single week. Mathis usually doesn't burp before it happens.
Mathis.
This time dude, it did.
19 hours late, orders a pizza, eats it during the stream, burps into the microphone. Showing a lot of care about the podcast right now.
Nick's Weird Games every single week. Nick's goes to get a weird game from his catalog of very many weird games. We try to guess which one it is based on the cues and hints he gives us. He'll read the description. He'll maybe show us some screenshots, maybe give us a little bit of an inkling of some cleavage. We'll see if he pulls down the shirt a little bit this time. Play along in chat as well if you want to. Twitch.tv/roundtablepodcast is where you're catching it live. Nick, what do you got? Well, first of all, every single week, Our good buddy here, Northern Lion, likes to... this is his choice he does entirely of his own volition. He likes to do a little rendition of the Nick's Weird Games theme song for us. So, I don't know, man. What do you...
We got to pick a Bowie song. Come on.
Oh, we do. That's true. We have to. And I don't want to force you to, you know, give your best rendition. But right. Know that whatever you do, it's in honor of a great man.
Sure, yeah. Yeah. So, okay. It would be like, bam, ba-dum, it's an Atlas banger. It's an RPG from 2002. It's a redux of Space Invaders.
Nice.
It came out for the PlayStation 2. You've never seen it. You probably know it really sucks. Online, it's $1,400. Yeah, that's good.
That was terrific. All right, good job, good job.
Well done.
Nick, what do we got?
All right, guys, it's time for another round. So last time we had a winner. We're going to see if we can repeat that. We've got a roughly equally difficult one today, I would say.
Let me hide chat real quick.
Oh, yeah, same. Yeah.
Nick is still way ahead in Nick's Weird Game points, by the way.
We're getting closer than you might expect. I'll add him up. I'll add him up soon.
Yeah.
So we've got another, PS2, Xbox, PC game this time. But we're looking at the PS2. So I'm just giving you the era. It's 2004. Okay. It's a survival horror third-person game.
Of course.
You might also mix in some science fiction, I suppose.
Galarians.
No, but I like where your head's at.
Yeah, you have that pause every time, man.
There is a chance that that would have been correct, but it is not today. This is published by PlayLogic, developed by Hydrovision Entertainment. And it features music by Sum 41. I didn't realize that before.
Oh, nice.
So any guesses so far?
I can't tell you now.
Publish. Well, that's a different thing than it says right there. Dreamcatcher Interactive. Oh, okay. It's different platforms at a different publisher. Sure, that makes sense.
Are we looking at, like, super obscure?
How do you mean?
I mean, it's not going to fall in, like, the Silent Hills, Resident Evil kind of popularity.
Oh, no, I'm not going to generally ever give you something that easy. But it's not... It's not harder than it was last time. Okay. All right, so I'll give you some stuff from the back then.
Please do.
What haunts the halls at Leafmore High?
Oh, God, the high school game.
Yep. That could be enough right there if you're thinking real hard about it. This next one should do it if that one doesn't.
Was Obscure the high school game?
Yes. That was the answer.
Oh, wow, man. Yes! Nice.
Holy Matt shit. Knows.
I played that game. Game was
there it is.
All right.
So when you asked,
is it obscure?
That's where I paused because I was like, so let's not blow the freaking load here. Let's take a minute. But yeah, this is obscure. Featuring
obscure
music
was not
by some
terrible.
Portable.
It was bad, but like... There are
the way
worse
that they
games.
Glorify the including music from Sum 41, that just totally throws me off, man. I look at that box there. Art and I think, oh, this looks kind of crazy. Music by Sum 41!
Dude, they're pretty heavy.
And spam. Yeah, I remember Obscure. I played Obscure. Apparently the chat saying is an Obscure 2 that's terrible, which I did not play.
Oh, good, yeah.
There is.
Soundtrack.
Obscure was all right, though.
24 tracks written and produced by Oliver Deriviere. Also, there are also two tracks that play during the game that are not included on the official soundtrack, and one of them is by Sum 41.
Oh. They couldn't get the licensing to distribute
what a
rip off.
Including and with music cut from the game by Sum 41.
Literally with one song by Sum 41. What a rip.
Who won in chat here? I'm trying to find
I have somebody. No idea.
Somebody said it.
The,
for sure. Yeah.
The first one I see is Mashamino. But I may have missed one before that.
Right.
I think it's you. Congrats.
Well done, Mashamino. And well done, Mathis. Yeah, we got another point. Shit, look at us.
Give me those weird horror games from that era. I've played a lot of them. So.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, me too.
Rule of Rose was one we talked about before. Galarians, I remember having hugely fond memories of.
Galarians.
Yeah, that was like weird psychic exploding head horror. It was bizarre.
But there was a couple of Galarians games, wasn't there?
I think there was two, yeah. One for the PS1, I think the second one was PS2.
Messiah?
I could just look over there. I'm pretty sure I have it. Yeah, whatever.
I need you guys to keep talking about old games while I validate my Patreon information real quick.
I'm marking down that we've got another win, actually, for you guys. I could add them up, actually.
Yo, did Bear just change his shirt? Am I freaking out?
You're freaking out.
Hoodie.
What?
Yo.
My hoodie might have folded over. Did this happen?
Ryan,
you have changed universes.
This guy's a sin.
No?
New universe.
Where did that hoodie come from?
That's it. That's the show. We've done it.
We did it, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
On time.
Yes. Exactly on time, as we intended. Thank you all so much for joining us for this episode of Roundtable. If this is your first time here, feel free to follow us here on twitch.tv/roundtablepodcast. You can catch the VOD of this over on any of our three YouTube channels. There's another person here. Twitch.tv/roundtablepodcast is what I just said. Roundtablepodcast.reddit.com, iTunes, SoundCloud, and soon coming to Google Play Music. And we want to thank our Patreon supporters as well for this episode. Patreon.com/roundtable is where you want to go if you want to consider supporting the podcast financially. We want to thank Christopher Flagg, Matt, Air Force Balls, Alexander Spillman, General Crunk, Jonathan Graham, Julian Avelsgard, Kevin Berkland, David Bradley, Gish Vandervet, Logan Ray, Samurfet, Super Mana Man, Mediocrities, Myth Scarab, Zur, Simph, Kevin L. Cy Kangaroo Walker, Ignacio0891, BrizzleBrip, Casey, Positron, and Justin. A lot of those names I've been reading for quite some time. So again, I really want to thank you guys.
Almost like from the beginning.
Yeah, seriously, for me, it's such long-term supporters. Apparently, BrizzleBrip has been supporting us on Patreon since January 1st of 1970. So that's really impressive.
Yeah. Wow.
Damn, dog.
that's the only one that says that on the list. I have no idea what's going on with that. But well done, BrizzleBrip. I appreciate that. 35 years of support. 45 years of support.
Almost.
Yeah. All right. Thank you guys so much for watching this episode of Roundtable Live. We appreciate your continued support, and we will see you on the show next time.
Definitely on Tuesday.
Goodbye.
Disco mode. Oh, it didn't work.